We are looking at chapter number 3, which is electricity, current electricity. So we'll talk about current and electricity. In the previous discussions, we have seen that all electric charges, whether they are free or they are bound, they were considered to be stationary. That means they were at rest. And we talked about the interaction between them. And this we called as, this branch of electricity we called as electrostatics. Why static? Because they were assumed to be at rest. Now, we will try to learn about the charges which are in motion. We'll provide them some energy, or whenever they will get some energy, we'll talk about charges in motion. So, these charges in motion are nothing but an electric current. When the charges are in motion, it is electric current. And it occurs in various situations when lightning in the sky, charges flow from the cloud to the earth because they want to ground, and through atmosphere they come to the earth. So flow of charges in lightning is of very short duration. So you can call it as a transient current, very short duration. So this flow of charges in lightning is not very steady, but there are various devices where charges flow in steady manner in everyday life, like the water which is flowing, the way, in the manner the water is flowing smoothly in a river. So a cell driven clock, a torch, a transistor radio, these are all examples of these devices. So we'll study some of the basic laws which are concerning the steady electric current and the quantities associated with this flow of charges, like the electric current density, what is drift velocity, what is the mobility, and we'll talk about the resistors, the cells, and there are different connections, the Kirchhoff rules for the analysis of different network, and how the conversion of electric energy into heat energy is happening when the conduction of electricity is going on through a conductor. Then we'll also try to see the potentiometer for the measurement of electromotive force, EMF, of a cell, and the Wheatstone bridge, which is employed for the measurement of resistor. So now we will talk about the current electricity, which is the branch of electricity. Electric current. When we have a charge and this charge is moving, it's flowing. So flow of electric charges are known as electric current. If say we have a net amount of charge Q, which is flowing through a, say, a cross-sectional area of the conductor in say time T, then the steady flow of charge I is given by Q by T. This is defined as the current which is flowing through this cross-sectional area. So the amount of charge, this is the definition, the amount of charge flowing per unit time, the amount of charge flowing per unit time across any cross-section of a conductor held perpendicular to the direction of the flow of the charge. This is very important. Now, if you assume like this, let me make like this. It is coming from this side and it's going like this. So this, say this is the center. This is 90 degree. This angle is 90 degree. So the cross section of a conductor which is held perpendicular to the direction of flow of charge is called the current I. So electric current I, we represent it by I, is considered to be a fundamental quantity, SI unit system. The SI unit of electric current is coulomb per second. Q for coulomb, T for second. So if we take Q as 1 coulomb and time as 1 second, then I will be equal to 1 ampere. 1 ampere. So this I will be 1 ampere. So if 1 coulomb of charge, it crosses any cross section like this of a conductor perpendicular to the direction of current in 1 second, then we say that the current through the cross section is said to be 1 ampere. If because the current can be very small as well, so we will generally talk about the milliamperes and microamperes. Milli is 10 to the power minus 3 ampere and micro is 10 to the power minus 6 ampere, like this. In metallic conductor, the current is due to the motion of negatively charged electrons. So electrons are negatively charged. Electrons can only move. So the current is due to electrons. In electrolytes, the current is due to the motion of both positive and negative ions, because you get H plus and Cl minus like this in HCl. So it is conducting electricity because of the positive and negative ions. They are moving in the opposite direction. In semiconductors, partly the electrons, and there are holes. Hole is where there is a deficiency of electron in a covalent bond. So we'll talk about this in greater detail in the next discussions. These are responsible for the flow of current. So let us understand by saying that I ampere current is flowing through this conductor like this. So I coulomb electric charge is flowing through every cross section. This is one cross section, two cross section, third cross section, every cross section of the conductor per second. So the amount of electric charge entering any cross section, say here, of a conductor from one side, is in a given time interval is equal to the amount of electric charge leaving that cross section from the other side. Means the amount going is amount coming outside in that interval of time. So because of this, electric charge is never accumulated at any point in the conductor. So the electric charge is neither created nor destroyed at any point in the conductor. That means we can say this is very important, because we'll use these in problems. This means that the electric charge is conserved. So traditionally, by convention, the direction of motion of positive charge is taken as the direction of electric current. So positive charge, that means opposite to electrons, the electrons flow here, the direction of current will be this direction. This is called conventional current. But in the conductors, the current is due to the motion of negatively charged electrons because of these electrons. So the direction of current is opposite to the electron current. The direction of current will be like this if the electrons are moving in this direction, because we assume protons never moves or positive charge never moves, but positive charge moves like this if electron is moving like this. So we say that the electric current in this direction. But in certain cases, the current, which is the rate of flow of charge Q by T, it varies with time, means the flow of charge is not steady. So in that situation, just assume that delta Q will be the net amount of electric charge which is flowing across any cross-sectional area of a conductor, say during delta T times. So it starts with T and say T plus delta T. So in between this time we are talking about. So the average electric current flowing through this time interval delta T, which is the time for which delta Q flows, is given by delta Q by delta T is this I. So the electric current at time T will be what? I will be this delta T. We need to be very small. So limit delta T tends to 0. Because this time interval we want as low as possible. So we say dq by dt. Whenever the limit is there, this delta changes to d. So this is dq by dt. The current flowing through a wire varies with time as I equal to I naught plus alpha t, where I naught is 10 ampere, alpha is 4 ampere per second. Find the charge that flows across a cross section of the wire in the first 10 seconds. So I is given by what? We know I is what? I is given by Q by T. When we are saying that the current is not steady, so we say I equal to dQ by dt. So this dQ by dt we can write here. So dQ by dt is I naught plus alpha T. That is why we are writing it. dQ by dt is I naught plus alpha T. Let us take dt here. So dQ becomes I naught plus alpha T into dt. Now we are integrating both the sides. So this becomes Q, and since we have to start with the initial, that is 0, and till 10 second we want, so 0 to 10 will integrate, the time will be 0 to 10 and I0 plus alpha t. The integration of I0 will be I0t, because I is constant, alpha t, t will be t square by 2, and we'll apply this limit 0 and 10 and subtract them. Now when we put this value I0 or I0 as 10 and this alpha as 4 here, so we get some value which is Q equal to 300 coulomb. Electric current density. So it is possible that the rate of flow of electric charge, which is actually the current, through cross-sectional area of the conductor may not be same. It is not always the case that it will always be same. And in addition to this, the flow of electric charge may not be perpendicular to the cross-sectional area of the conductor. As you see here, this is the cross-sectional area. Here, the charge are moving perpendicular to the cross-sectional area. But here, the case is not that. So in these type of circumstances, to study the flow of charge through cross-sectional area of a conductor at any point, we need to have a vector quantity, which is known as the electric charge density J. It's a vector quantity, so it is J bar. This is defined. So this is electric current density. In order to define the current density at point P, we assume a very small area. This is delta A. Again, we are taking delta A here. The case is the electric field, current direction is not perpendicular to the cross-sectional area. Okay, so this is delta A, very small area we have taken, and this is delta A through P perpendicular to the flow of charge, as you see here. Now delta A is perpendicular in this case, first case, but in second case delta A is not perpendicular, but in fact it is making angle theta with the direction of current. So this is delta A, let us take it as theta. So the direction which is parallel to the delta I is delta A cos theta, which is perpendicular to it will be delta A sin theta. So this delta I be the current through this delta A in this case. So what we say, J, this J we define as delta I, that is the current by area, that is delta I by delta A. Delta I is the current through the area delta A. So the average current density J will be delta I by delta A. And the current density at some point P, P here, because we want this area to be as small as possible. So we take the limit delta A tends to 0. So delta I by delta A becomes dI by dA. So the direction of the current density is same as the direction of the current. If a current I is uniformly distributed, say on some area A, and it is perpendicular to it, so we just say J will be equal to I by A. I hope you got the idea. J equal to dI by dA. The direction, because we say that the electric charge is not perpendicular, or the current direction is not perpendicular to the area of cross section, but other case when it is perpendicular, J will be I by A. So the electric current density at any point can be defined as the amount of electric current flowing per unit cross sectional perpendicular to the current at that point, right? So J equal to I by A. The SI unit of current density, because it is current by area, so it is ampere per meter square. Now let us take the other case. Let us consider the cross section A. In this case, this discussion was entirely for this case. Now let us take the other case. Now consider a cross section area delta A here, which is not perpendicular to the current. So we have to take the component. Component of the cross section in the direction of current. So if it is like this, this is the current, this is the perpendicular to this area, so it is making theta with the current. Say this is delta A, delta A cos theta A will be this component. So delta A cos theta we are going to take. So the average current density, we know that delta A by delta I by delta A, in this case we'll take the component, so it will be delta I by delta A cos theta. This delta I is the current flowing through small area delta A, and theta is the angle made by the normal is this perpendicular to this area of cross section with the direction of the current. So if we take delta A very small, because if we want to compute it for the whole area, delta A has to be very small. So J will be the density will be, current density will be like delta I tends to 0, delta I by delta I cos theta. And because delta I tends to 0, so this delta changes to dI by dA cos theta. Now take this dA cos theta on this side, right? So this becomes dI equal to J, this was J. So J into dA cos theta will be equal to, dI will be equal to J dA cos theta. So dI becomes J dot dA, because this is the dot product. J dA cos theta is nothing but J dot dA. Now let us take the surface integration over the entire cross section area. So we need to integrate these two. So this integration will be whole current, which is passing through the complete cross-section area. And this is for all area, this is J dot D. If the cross-section area is perpendicular to the current, then this cos theta component will be what? It will be 0, cos 0 is 1. So ultimately this I equal to integration J dot dA will be J integration of dA, dA will be complete area. So I will be equal to J, J will be equal to I by A. That was our previous case when the direction of current was perpendicular to the cross-sectional area. So the concept of electric charge or electric current density is very important when we discuss the flow of electric charges. 0.2 millimeter diameter copper wire is connected to 5 millimeter diameter iron wire. The current flows through both the wires. If 8 ampere current flows through the copper wire, then calculate the following quantities. The current flowing through the iron wire and current density, and the current density in the copper wire. So we have to see the areas here. Because the conservation of law is there for charges, so equal amount of time is taken for a given quantity of charge to enter the copper wire and to enter the copper wire and to leave the iron wire. So we say I copper wire will be 8.0, this will be equal to IFE. That is why both will have current as 8 ampere. Now let us take the area of the iron part. This is the cross-sectional area of iron wire, and let us take this DFE and RFE be the radius and diameter of this area where we have iron. So J is given by I by A for iron. Area is pi r square, right? We are not taking the complete area, we are just taking this cross-section area. This is the cross-section. So pi r square. Now what all is given? This is given, right? We have this as phi, so we have to take r, this r is simply d by 2, so we will take like this. This is 5 millimeter, so we'll take 5 by 2, and pi is already there, 3.14, and the value of JFE will be, or J will be, for iron will be 407 and kilo ampere per meter square. In the similar fashion, JCU will be same current will take I, and area will be now this area. This will be equal to pi into d by 2 whole square. And pi into d is what? 0.2 by 2 whole square. We'll put it here, and this will be the value. The current density along the axis of cylindrical conductor having radius equal to r is given by J equal to J0 1 minus r square, small r square by capital R square. Find the current along the length of the conductor. The distance of the axis is given by r. So we will consider a ring, say of thickness, this very small thickness. We will take a ring, and the thickness is dr, which is say at a distance r from the axis, which is this. This distance is smaller from the axis on the cross section perpendicular to the axis of the cylinder. So we know that di is given by j dot da, because cos 0 is 1, both are in the same direction, means this, the perpendicular normal to the cross-sectional area and the current direction are same. So cos 0 will be 1. So it will be JDA. What is J? J is given by J0 1 minus R square by capital R square. So we'll put it here. J0 1 minus R square by DR square. And what will be the area? Area will be 2 pi R into H. Right? 2 pi R. Area is the cross-sectional area. Please understand, it is 2 pi R. This one. Right? So what we have to take here is, we have taken this, now we need to find out the area. So this area will be 2 pi r into dr. This is 2 pi r and the thickness. So 2 pi r into, because we are taking the, this is small r. So 2 pi r into dr. This thickness is dr. Now the current along the length of the conductor, which is integration of this, will take from 0, means from center to total R, this we want to find out for the whole one. So integration will be from R0 to capital R, and this will be the value we just found out. Take the constant out and integrate this from 0 to R. Integration of this is going to give you this. I hope that you will be able to do the integration by yourself. and we'll just put the limit 0 and r. So finally you get this expression. I leave this for you, but the basic idea was how to find this and how to come to the conclusion. Ohm's law. When we are touching 6 volt supply, why we are not experiencing shock, fatal shock? But if you touch 230 volt, you will experience a fatal shock, electricity shock. So different voltages are there. So electric current flow through the body is different because of this different voltage. In 1828, great German scientist George Simon Ohm, he was the first pioneer to give a mathematical relationship between the voltage and the current, V and C. And this is known famously as Ohm's law. So he proved experimentally that under a definite physical condition, that is constant temperature, the current I flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference applied across the end. So what Ohm's law is saying, that I is directly proportional to V, or you can say I by V is constant, V by I is constant. So V by I is a constant ratio, and this he called as resistor of the conductor. So V equal to IR is the Ohm's law. The SI unit of resistance is volt by ampere, and this is known as ohm. Resistor is experienced in ohm, and it is denoted by this sign, which is ohm. So at a given temperature, the resistance R not only depends on the material of the conductor, but also on the dimension of the conductor. What is the reciprocal of R? R is the resistance. So what is 1 by R? This is known as the conductance of the material. It is given as ohm to the power minus 1, or we call it as MHO, moho. And you can also see in some book like this, you know, opposite or 180 degree turn to the ohm sign. So Ohm law is not a fundamental law like we have gravitational law of Newton or the Coulomb's law of electrical charges, but it gives a relationship between the V, potential difference across the conductor, and I, the current flowing through it under certain condition. See, all the metals, some of the insulators and some of the electrical devices, they obey the Ohm's law, and these devices are known as ohmic devices. This is the I and V graph of a conductor. This is current, this is V. So you see there is a straight line. Ohm's law at a constant temperature, and it will be a straight line. So at temperature T1, at temperature T2, you will see always that the V by I, or you can say delta V by delta I, will always be constant in both the cases, right? Will always be constant. You can say delta I by delta V, that is I, 1 by R, that is the conductance, will always be constant. Limitations of Ohm's law. So there are some materials and devices which are used in circuit where this proportionality between V and I does not hold. So in these devices, what can happen? The VI relation, they are not always linear. Okay, this is I, this is V. We are saying in the Ohm's law that V by I will always be constant, and we call it as a resistance. But in these cases, VI relations are not constant. In fact, in semiconductor devices like diode and triodes, it will be something like this. The relationship between V and I depends on the sign of voltage also. In other terms, this I, that is the current for a certain voltage V, then reversing the direction of V, keeping the magnitude fixed, it will not produce a current of same magnitude I in the opposite direction. So this happens again in semiconductor diode, which we'll study in the later discussions. So the graph between V and I should be like this here. Then the relationship between V and I, this is also not unique. That is, there is more than one value of V for same current I. For same current I, there can be multiple values of V. So a graph of a device which shows such behavior, which is the tunnel diode, is shown like this. See, for a same I, we have different V1, V2 and V3 value. Electrical resistivity and conductivity. So what is the dependence of resistance R of a conductor? Say we have a conductor. So what is the dependence of this R of a conductor on the dimensions of the conductor? This is some conductor. Just consider a conductor, say, having a cross-sectional area A, length L. So experimentally, it is found that at given temperature T, the resistance R of a conductor is proportional to the length of conductor, and it is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area. So what this says is, resistance is directly proportional to length, resistance is inversely proportional to area. We combine them, we say resistance is directly proportional to L by A. And this alpha we change, because this is a proportionality, so we change it as a constant. So this is rho. What is this rho? This rho is called the resistivity of the material, and this rho depends on the material of the conductor, temperature and the pressure which is existing in given conductor. So it does not depend on the dimensions of the conductor. So the unit of resistivity, this rho, is ohm meter. So there is the resistivity of a material, it changes at high pressure due to the changes in the composition of crystal. This is for information. Now let us apply the Ohm's law. V equal to IR is our Ohm's law. Now R is given by rho L upon A. Let us put it here. So we get V equal to I rho L upon A, which is V equal to, and we know this I by A can be written as J, current density. So V equal to J rho L. Now if E is the magnitude of electric field in the conductor whose length is L, then the potential difference V will be what? V equal to E into D, that is E into L, length is L. So now V equal to J rho L, so we can write EL equal to J rho L. L gets cancelled, E equal to J rho. So the current density is a vector quantity and it is directed along the direction of this electric field. So this equation now can be written in the vector form as E equal to J into rho. This J is given by what? Take it here, E by rho, and we know that this 1 by rho can be written as some other constant or some other value or some other quantity, which is actually the reciprocal of resistivity, which is called as the conductivity. So now this is the conductivity, and the unit of this conductivity is ohm meter minus 1, moho meter minus 1. You can rightly like this, or this moho can be said as siemen per meter, right? Now this equation we just got is the vector form of the Ohm's law. Drift velocity, mobility and its relation with current. So in atom and molecules, the negatively charged electron and the positively charged nuclei, this is nucleus and electrons are orbiting, so this is positively charged, these are bound to each other and there is a Coulombian force between them. And bulk matter is made up of many molecules, so we'll try to focus only on the solid conductors in which the current is carried by the negatively charged free electrons. So in metallic conductor, the electrons in the outermost shell or outer shell, these are less bound with the nucleus. And due to thermal energy at room temperature, these valence electrons which are outside orbiting, these are liberated from atom, leaving behind the positively charged ion. So if we have this nucleus and it consists of proton and neutron, and these are electrons orbiting. So these electrons are liberated from the atom and these are called as free electrons. And these ions, because if the electron has gone, this becomes more positive. The atom becomes more positive, and the free electrons and ions, these are oscillating about their mean position. If there is no electric field, free electrons in a solid conductor, they move just like the molecules in the gas due to their thermal velocity. During their motion, they collide with the ions, and the direction of their velocity after the collision, they are completely random. So at any given instant of time, there is no preferential direction where it could be for the velocities of the electron when there is no electric field. Such random motion of electron is seen like this, it can go like this, it can go like this. So it's a random motion. So on an average, the number of electrons traveling in any direction will be equal to the number of electrons which are traveling in the opposite direction. Electron may go this way, some electron may go this way. So essentially, they are moving all together in opposite direction if there is no external electric field. So the net charge which is passing through any cross section of the conductor will be zero. So there will be no flow of current, electric current in the conductor in the absence of electric field. Now, an electric field E is applied across the conductor by connecting a battery between two ends of the conductor, as you see here. So due to the electric field in the conductor, the electron will experience some force F equal to charge into electricity, the electric field. So this will be F equal to E on the electron. So it is E, capital E into E. This is electric field. This is the charge of the electron in the direction which is opposite to the electric field, that is towards the positive terminal of the battery. So the path of the electron will become like this. It will be properly in the form of AB, like this. Okay. Electron will be there, so electric field will be in this direction, they will move opposite. Now, this is because the electron executing in the motion under the oscillatory electric field of the ion constantly gets scattered from its path. This gives rise to the resistance in the conductor. Now, some resistance will be there. And in the presence of electric field now, we have applied electric field because of the battery. We have used a battery. So the acceleration of the electron in the direction which is opposite to the electric field, acceleration will be what? Force by mass, F equal to ma. Force is E in capital E into small e. So this acceleration of electron is momentary, since the electrons are continuously, they are colliding with the ions. Basically, the electrons are scattering in the oscillating electric field of the ions. So because of this result, the electrons are dragged in the opposite direction to the electric field. So if electric field is like this, electron will be dragged like this. So the velocity of the electron becomes zero after every oscillation with the ions. And after each collision, the electron is accelerated once again. It collides with ion, stops, again accelerate due to the electric field, and then again collide with the ions. And this process goes on and on. So the electron travel from, say, A to B in the presence of, say, A to B dash in the presence of electric field. So it will not travel in AB, because traveling from AB in the absence of electric field, in presence of electric field, it will move in certain direction. So the effective displacement of the electron is equal to what? See, this is, you have to see here, this is A, this is B, and this is B dash. So it will move in the red is when there was no electric field, but when there was electric field, it moves like this. So we say that effective displacement is equal to BB dash in the presence of electric field. Now the velocity of electron corresponding to this displacement is known as drift velocity. V sub d, d is the subscript. So what is this? The velocity of electron corresponding to this displacement in the electric field is called the drift velocity. So in this scenario, the average number of electron passing through any cross-sectional area of the conductor is not zero, because there is a presence of electric field. There will be a net flow of charge of conductor through the conductor, net flow of charge of a current through the conductor. So the average time between two consecutive collision of electron with the ion, electron will collide with the ion, is called the relaxation time. This is the relaxation time. So what is the relaxation time? The average time between successive collision of electron with the ion is the relaxation time. So the drift velocity which is achieved by electron in this relaxation time tau, this is the time. So what it will be, this is velocity, right? And this is the time. So time, we know that V will be equal to acceleration into time. Initial velocity we say equal to 0. So V equal to U plus AT. We say this is 0. So V will be equal to A into T. Here velocity V is the drift velocity. Acceleration will be acceleration and T is the tau. So now acceleration is got what? A equal to capital E small e by M. So Vd will be equal to capital E small e by M into tau. Relation between the drift velocity and current density. In order to find the relation between the current density and the drift velocity, we will have to consider a cylindrical conductor of uniform cross-sectional area as you see here. An electric field E exists in the conductor when its ends are connected to certain battery. So if the drift velocity of electron is Vd, then the distance traveled by electron during say delta t time, this distance will be Vd into delta t. Distance will be equal to velocity into time. So the volume of the portion of the conductor whose length say is this much is A into L. This area is the area of cross section and L is the length from this point to this point. So area into length. So what will be the length? Length is given by Vd into delta t. So area into length Vd into delta t. A into Vd into delta t. So now consider there are n free electrons per unit volume. That is the number density of the electrons. So the number of free electrons in this is this area from this point to this point will be how much? N into this whole, N into A into Vd into delta t. So all these electrons, they cross this area of cross section at delta t time. We have taken delta t from this point to this point. So the charge crossing the area in delta t will be what? What will be charge? Charge will be this whole multiplied by the electron charge. So you get N into A into Vd into delta t into E. This is the delta q. Now what will be the current? Current is given by delta q by delta t. Let us divide this by delta t. Delta t, delta t gets cancelled. So you get delta q by delta t as N into A into V into E. So what is current density? J equal to I by A. Now let us divide this by A. This A gets cancelled. It will be N into A into Vd. So in general, in vector form, we can write J as the current density equal to N into Q, this E is the charge, into Vd, and this Vd is the drift velocity. This is the relation. So for a negative charge Q, this J in Vd will be in the opposite direction. So now from this equation, we just saw N into V into N into Q into Vd, right? This is equal to J, and J was what? J was sigma into E. So sigma into E and E, let us write again for Vd, this force into time, force into time. So F is E, capital E into E by M into tau. So now sigma will become, let us take this on the other side. So sigma, let us cancel this E. This will be E square N into tau into E square by M. So sigma becomes N E square tau by M. Sigma is what? 1 by rho. Right, 1 by rho, resistivity and conductivity. So rho is equal to 1 by sigma. So this rho becomes, let us take the inversion or reciprocal of this. So rho becomes m by n e square by tau. This is the relationship. So if a metal or in a metal, the number density this n is not dependent on the temperature. So the oscillation of ion will increase with temperature and this will become more erratic or random. So the relaxation time tau will decrease. So the resistivity of the conductor increases with temperature according to this formula. So for insulators and semiconductors, the relaxation time tau and number density n of charge carriers, it will vary with temperature. So the number density n of charge carriers will increase with temperature in semiconductors. So therefore, the conductivity of semiconductor increases with temperature, that is the resistivity is going to go down. (3a) Current is flowing through two identical conducting wires having diameter this much. So these conducting wires are then split into three identical conducting wires, each having 0.1 diameter as you see. This is 0.1, this is 0.2, and this is 3 ampere. Now calculate the drift velocity in the thicker and thinner conductors, means Vd here and Vd here. So the electron density of is given by this value. All the conductors are made of same material and the electrical charge of an electron is given by this. So let us take first the thicker portion. J is equal to I by A. I is given by 3. Area is, this means cross section is pi r square. So r is given, this is because diameter is 0.2, r will be 0.1 centimeter. We convert it into proper units and this will be the J. And we also know J can be related to the drift velocity by J equal to n into e into vd. This is drift velocity. So vd will be j by ne. J is this much, n is number of electrons, right? N is the number of electrons, and e is the charge of electron, right? So now we can put this n and e, and we get the vd. Vd is our drift velocity, right? So now 6 ampere color, this first part we have just seen. The electron density, we, you know, this what we have done here is, this electron density was, because Vd equal to J by N into E, and we put this value electron density 7 into 10 to the power 28, the charge, and the same thing we are going to do here. So the total current flowing through each of the wire here is, we are coming now to the second part. This Vd will be equal to Vd dash, let us say, J dash by NE. Again, we'll use the same criteria. This is 0.1, so it will be 0.1 by 2. Radius will be this one. Pi r square will be the area. And 2, J dash, J you have to find out. So J, for that we have to use this formula. And this is given by electron density, and 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 is our charge. So this is given by 2.3 into 10 to the power minus 4. A copper wire is stretched to make it 0.1% longer. What is the percentage change in its resistance? We have to assume that the volume of wire remained constant. So suppose that the length of the wire, let us take it like this. Length of the wire is L and the cross-section area is A. So we know that R equal to rho L by A, right? So this rho L by A, rho L by A, now we can multiply L here, means multiply and divide by L. This AL will become volume, this will be L square, so this will be volume. Now let us take dr by dl. If you take dr by dl with respect to L square differentiated, this will give you 2L. So this dr will become, let us take dr dl here, this will be rho by V, 2L into dl. Now in both this equation we see dr, now again divide this by r, divide dr by r. So we have to divide this r with this one, rho v by L square by what we have got here. So we get dr by r equal to 2 into dl by L, because this gets cancelled. So this is what we have to find out is the percentage change. So dr by r into 100 will be the percentage change, which is simply equal to 2 into dl by L. What is dl by L? It is given as 0.1%, right? 2 into 0.1%. So this is given by 2 into 0.1, that is 0.2%. This is the resistance of a wire will increase by 0.2%. Mobility. What is mobility? We have seen that the conductivity of material is due to mobile charge carriers. So mobile charge carriers in the conductor, these are free electrons. In a gas, ionized gas situation, there are electrons and positive ions. This positive and negative, they both types of ions, these are mobile charge carriers in the electrolytes as well. In semiconductors, the flow of electron is partly because of electrons and partly because of the holes. So let us compare the equations we have seen of current density. J was equal to sigma E, and J was also equal to N into E into Vd. Let us equate them. So Vd by E equal to sigma by NE, we are just rearranging. So this Vd by E, this is the drift velocity of a charge carrier per unit electric field intensity. And this is nothing but the Vd by E is nothing but the mobility, or you can say it is a mu mobility of charge carrier. So mu is given by Vd by E, you can also find it out by sigma by NE. The SI unit of this mobility is M square by V by S. And from this, it is very clear that sigma is given by NE into mu. NE into mu. This is another equation. So if charge carriers are electron, we can put this as electron. All these subscript can be changed to electron. So sigma for holes, sigma H will be NH E mu H. We are changing the subscript to H. If you talk about a semiconductor, then there are holes and the electrons. They will both constitute, because they both are the charges there in the same direction. So sigma will be equal to sigma E, means electron plus hole. The sigma will be equal to both formula we are using, this one and this one, for electron and holes. Temperature dependence of resistivity. So resistivity of a material is found to be dependent on the temperature. So different materials, they do not exhibit the same dependence on temperature, and because of the range of temperature, limited range of temperature, if it is not too large, the relationship between the resistivity and the of a metallic conductor and the temperature can be shown like this. Rho theta is equal to, this is the resistivity at temperature theta. Rho theta 0, that means this is the resistivity at proper reference temperature. This is 1 plus alpha. Alpha is the temperature coefficient of resistivity, which is 1 by degree centigrade or 1 by Kelvin. And theta minus theta 0, theta 0 are the temperature. So this equation, you can write it in the form of resistance, because rho is R is equal to rho L by A. So this rho theta can be written as R theta, because L and A are constant. So R theta will be equal to R theta 0, 1 plus alpha theta minus theta 0. So the resistivity rho and the temperature coefficient alpha of some elements are given here. These are the values of rho and alpha for different material. For example, if you take silver, at 0 degree temperature, resistivity is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 8, and temperature coefficient alpha is 0.0041. So these are the values for conductors and semiconductors and insulators. And if you see this table more carefully, we noted that the metal alpha is positive. If you go back, the alpha is positive. All are positive. But for this, it is negative. For a semiconductor, it is negative. Insulator, there is no value. So the resistivity of metal increases with temperature. That is why alpha is positive. For metallic conductor, the relationship between the alpha and the temperature is non-linear at lower temperature, that is less than 50 Kelvin. And the graph becomes linear near the room temperature. And finally, at very high temperature, the graph again becomes non-linear. So this is the diagram for the metal, and it shows that when we draw it between rho and T, this is the curve being formed. And there are some materials like nichrome, which is an alloy of nickel, iron and chromium. They have very high value of rho resistivity, and they exhibit very weak dependence of resistivity on the temperature. If you see this figure, so the resistivity of manganin, which is again an alloy of copper, magnesium, manganese and nickel, is almost dependent on temperatures. Therefore, we have a straight line if you see that. So the resistivity of nichrome does not become zero even at absolute temperature, 0 Kelvin, while the resistivity of pure metal will become almost zero at absolute zero temperature. And using this fact, we can test the purity of metal. And if you see the table, just now we discussed about that, semiconductor like the carbon, germanium and silicon, they have negative value of alpha. See, the carbon, germanium, silicon, they have negative value of alpha. So this negative value of alpha, this means that the resistivity of such material, they decrease with temperature. So it is shown like this. This increases, this decreases. For some in between, like the nichrome, etc., and the other one we talked about, manganin, the relation is something like this. Classification of material on the basis of resistivity. So the material can be classified as conductor, semiconductor, and insulator, and depending upon their resistivities. So an ideal conductor, it has zero resistivity or infinite conductivity. They both are. If it is infinite resistivity, that means it has zero conductivity. For ideal conductor, zero resistivity and infinite conductivity. While the ideal insulator, they have finite resistivity, that is zero conductivity. So metal, they have low resistivity, that is from 10 to the power minus 8 ohm meter to 10 to the power minus 6 ohm meter. And at the other end, our insulator, like the ceramic, like rubber, the plastic, they have resistivity 10 to the power 18 times greater than the metals. It may be more than that. But semiconductor is somewhere in between these two. So they have resistivity characteristically decreasing with the rise of temperature. And the resistivity of semiconductors, they are also affected by if you have some impurities in it. So it is generally found that good conductors of electricity, like the metals, these are also good conductors of heat. Superconductors are the exception. While the bad conductor of electricity, like ceramic and plastic, they are also found to be the bad conductors of heat. Resistors which are used in lab, there are two types, wire wound resistors and carbon resistors. So wire wound resistors, these are made by winding the wires of alloy, that is manganin, constantan, nichrome or similar ones on a proper base. The resistivity of these materials, they do not change appreciably with the temperature. While the carbon resistor, which is another resistor type used in laboratories, the carbon resistors are widely used in electronic circuit like the radios, television and amplifier. So the carbon resistor, they have very small dimension and it is very inexpensive, right? To make a carbon resistor, pure graphite is mixed with resin, which is molded into a cylinder at high temperature and pressure. This wire lead to or wire leads, the ends are attached to two ends of a cylinder and the entire resistor is insulated in a insulating jacket made up of ceramic or plastic. So carbon resistors are available in the range from 1 ohm to 100. M is mega ohm. Color code of carbon resistor. So the value of carbon resistor is found from the color bands, which is marked on the surface of the cylinder of the carbon resistor. This is an example. So let us take the resistor and color code and we'll see how to understand this. So the color of first band on the resistor shows its value in tens. The color of the second band shows its value in units. The digit for different colors, we'll just see if you see it is in the figure. So the third band will imply what? It implies the number found by the first and second digit, and it is to be multiplied by 10 to the power n. So the multiplier 10 to the power n for different colors are given here in the color codes. So the fourth color band shows the possible deviation, which is the tolerance, if you see here, in the value of resistor. So we have different colors, they are different colors. So all these different colors, and this is the digit 1, this is digit 2, this is the multiplier, and this is the tolerance. So let me tell you again, the color codes are something like this. The first is the digit 1, second is the digit 2, the third is the multiplier 10 to the power n, and this one is the tolerance. Okay, for example, if red is there, this color is red, so the tolerance will be plus minus 2%. If this is say yellow, so it will be 10 to the power into 10 to the power 4. So this is like what we have to compute. So we'll take an example. Okay, if you see this figure, the first band on the resistor is yellow. This is yellow. And the digit of this color is, see, what is, see here carefully, it is yellow. So the number is 4. For yellow, the number is 4. The second band is violet. Violet. And the corresponding digit is what? See, violet. What is the corresponding digit? It is 7. So we write 7. So the number formed due to the combination of these two digits is 47. And the third color band is orange. If you see, this is orange. Now the orange, let us see what is in front of orange. The multiplier is 10 to the power 3. This is multiplier. So now we multiply it by 10 to the power 3. 10 to 10 to the power 3 is kilo, so it is 47 kilo ohm. The last color band is golden. So let us see golden, which is plus minus 5%. So which is indicating the value of resistor calculated above can have a variation of 5%. So we write plus minus 5%. So the value of resistor is 47 kilo ohm plus minus 5%. This is how we, because of the color code, we can find out the value of the resistor. Superconductivity. In 1911, Dutch physicist Kamerlingh Ons, he experimentally discovered that the resistivity of mercury absolutely disappears, becomes zero, or at temperature below 4.2 Kelvin. And as per his observation, at 4.3 Kelvin temperature, the resistivity of mercury is about 0.084 ohm, and at 3 Kelvin temperature, it becomes 3 into 10 to the power minus 6 ohm, which is 10 to the power 6 part of the resistance as zero. So this showed us that the resistance of certain material reduced to almost zero when its temperature is lowered below a certain definite temperature, which is known as a critical temperature TC. So the material in this state is known as a superconductor. There is no resistivity. There is no resistance, so it is superconductor. And this phenomena is known as superconductivity. So it's a proper or specific state of a material. So most of the metals and alloys, they can achieve this state of superconductivity. Some of the semiconductor like the silicon, germanium, SET, they exhibit the state of superconductivity under high pressure and low temperatures. So the current flowing through a superconductor, this can be sustained over a long period of time. So the reason is that in an ordinary conductor, the electric energy is dissipated as heat energy because of the resistance offered by the conductor. While in superconductor, there will be no loss of electric energy since the resistor or resistance of this superconductor is almost zero. So what we saw here, using superconductor, the problem of energy loss during the transmission of electrical energy, this can be solved. There is one more fact we ignored, is that the temperature of the material should be lower to critical temperature, which is our TC. So liquid helium and liquid nitrogen, these are used to achieve the temperature of the material below this critical temperature. The situation can be best described by a proverb, penny wise, pound foolish. So the best of the normal conductors, they have high critical temperature, but very, very, very much lower than room temperature than the oxide alloys. So which shows us that compared to the normal conductor, the insulators like the ceramic, they can easily achieve the state of superconductivity. So superconductivity is a specific state of material. And because of the latest research, this critical temperature TC of compound HGBACACUO can be raised up to 164 Kelvin. Such superconductors, these are known as HTS or high temperature superconductors. This HTS has application in the areas of thin film devices, electrical transmission over long distance, levitating trains, that is maglev trains, which can achieve a speed of 550 km an hour. The resistance of a platinum wire of platinum resistance thermometer at the ice point is 5 ohm and at steam point is 5.23 ohm. When the thermometer is inserted in a hot bath, the resistance of the platinum wire is 5.795 ohm. Calculate the temperature of the bath. So here in the question, this R0 is given as 5 ohm at ice point. R100 steam point is given 5.23 ohm. R theta is given as at some temperature 5.795. So we'll use this equation. R theta is equal to R theta 0 1 plus alpha theta minus theta 0. Because this theta 0 is 0, it is given in the question. So R theta becomes R0 1 plus alpha t, alpha theta. So now we can take this on the left hand side, R theta minus R0 will be equal to R0 alpha theta. For stream, this is equal to 100. So R 100 minus R 0 will be R 0 alpha, and theta we will take as 100. So for heat bath, if it is steam, then it is this value. How about heat bath? We don't know the temperature, so we'll keep it as theta. This also has R theta. Now we'll divide these two equations. R theta minus R 0, R 100 minus R 0, theta by 100. Theta will be given by what? Let us take 100 here. Now we know this R theta. We know this R 0. We know this R 100 as well. So we'll put all these value and we get theta equal to 346.65. Two materials having alpha 1 and alpha 2 as these values. The resistivity of first material is this. A new material is made by combining these two materials. The resistivity does not change with temperature. What should be the resistivity of the second material? Consider the reference temperature as 20 degree centigrade and assume that the resistivity of new material is equal to the sum of resistivity of its component material. So the reference temperature given is 20 degree. We'll use the equation resistivity of a material at temperature theta will be rho theta is equal to rho 20. This is our reference temperature 1 plus alpha theta minus 20. And d rho theta by d theta will be what? Rho 20 into alpha. This also we know. For first material, this rho theta d rho theta by d theta 1 will be equal to rho 20 into alpha 1. For second, rho theta by d theta for second will be rho 22 into alpha 2. What will be the resistivity of mixture? We'll add rho theta 1 and rho theta 2. This does not change with temperature. So this is the final value. So we'll put this rho theta 1 and rho theta 2. We'll add them and we'll equate it to 0. So this is, we add them equate to 0 because this is essentially equal to this value only. And we'll take 1 on the right hand side. So now in this place we can write this value. In this place we can write, put this value. So rho 21, alpha 1 will equal to minus rho 22 for the second one, alpha 2. So rho 22, that is second value, we can find out by just rearranging this. Now we know this value, this is given, 2 into 10 to the power 8. Alpha 1, alpha 2 is also given, since alpha 1 and alpha 2 is also given, we'll put it here. And the rho 20 for the second one will be 2.4 into 10 to the power minus 8 ohm meter. A tungsten filament of bulb has resistance equal to 18 ohm at 20 degree temperature. 0.185 ampere of current flows when 30 volt is connected to it. If alpha is equal to this value for tungsten, then we find the temperature of the filament. So from ohm law we know V equal to Ri, so I will be equal to V by R. This I, this R theta, basically resistance of at some temperature theta is V by I. V is also known, I is also known. So V and I are known, so we'll put here, it is equal to 162 ohm. When the bulb is on, the resistance is given as 162 ohm, we just found out. So R theta will be equal to R theta 0, 1 plus alpha theta minus theta 0. This R theta will take as 162. R theta 0, which is given at this, is equal to 18. 1 plus alpha, alpha is also given. Theta minus theta 0 will take as 293, right? Because of 20 degree, 273 plus 20 is 293. Now we can find out theta. This is 2070.7 Kelvin. EMF, electromotive force and terminal voltage of a cell. What we have talked about is current, which is constituting the charged particle which is moving. Now, in order to have motion, there must be some force. There must be some force exerted on them. Or you can say that energy has to be applied to the charged particle in order to have them moving. The device which serves this objective or purpose is called the EMF, is called the source of electromotive force. So there are many ways in which the force can be exerted on a charge. For instance, the force exerted on the charge in an electric cell is why? Because of the chemical processes. The force can be exerted on the charge due to varying the magnetic field, or you can have it by having temperature difference. So all these are mentioned devices, and these are source of EMF. So a battery or a cell is also a source of EMF. So what does this EMF, electromotive force, mean? We'll take an example to understand this. So this figure, it shows a schematic diagram of a battery. So there are positive and negative charge. These are positive and negative charges. These are present in the chemical of a battery. And because of certain chemical reactions which are taking place in the battery, the force is exerted on these charges. And such a force, which is a chemical force or non-electrical, because it is a chemical force because of the chemical composition of the material. So we call it as a Fn. Fn, this force, n is for, this is non-electric force. Now this force drives positive charge toward one terminal. See, positive charge towards one terminal like this, and drives the negative charge to another terminal. Say terminal, this goes to A, this goes to B. This goes to A and this goes to B, like this. So the positive and negative charge, these are built up on the positive and negative terminal because of the chemical reactions, they are moving. A potential difference is created, or you can say an electric field is created between them, which is increasing gradually. And because of this, the electric force, which is Fe, the electric force Fe, is exerted on the charge Q in the direction which is opposite to Fn. If Fn is this side, non-electrical, Fe will be like this because of the electric field and potential difference being created. So in the steady state, the charges stop accumulating further at the terminal A and B when this force, non-electric force, is equal to the electric force. So in this case, the work done by a non-electric force, that is Fn, in taking the unit positive charge from negative terminal to positive terminal will be what? This is a line, Fn, non-electric force, dot dl, some distance. This is a line integral. This is from the negative to positive terminal because we are taking the electrons being moved. And as per the definition of electric motive force, this work done is equivalent to the electromotive force. This is equivalent to electric motive force. So we come to the definition of EMF, which is like this. When unit positive force is driven from negative to positive terminal due to non-electric force, the energy gained by the charge or work done by non-electric force is called the EMF of that battery. So EMF is again in volt because it's joule by coulomb in the memory of great scientist Volta, right? So EMF, again, let me tell you, EMF is not a force. EMF is not a force, but it is energy per unit charge. Energy per unit charge. In the steady state of a battery, when these two forces are equal, Fn equal to Fe, the electric charge in the battery, it does not execute any motion. That is, there will be no current flowing through the battery. That is, I equal to zero in the steady state when they both are opposite and equal. So in this condition, the battery is said to be in open circuit condition. So the circuit is open. Now consider a wire, say, of resistance R connected across two terminal of a battery here. So these are the two terminal, and there is a resistance or resistive wire here. So the electric field is established in this wire. Because of this, the positive charge, which are at the higher potential, will move toward the negative terminal of a battery in this wire, and it will constitute an electric current. So the question comes as to why didn't the positive charge move towards the negative terminal inside the battery rather than the longer route of the wire. So the reason, because of the reason for this, is the non-electric force which oppose the motion of positive charges towards the negative terminal of the battery inside the battery. So the energy of the positively charged, a positive charge, is consumed against this resistance of the wire, and by the time it reaches the negative terminal here, the energy becomes zero, and this happens at every rotation of its motion. So during the flow of current, the positive charge is moving from negative to positive charge because of non-electric forces. And because of this motion, the charge has to pass through chemical materials of which is inside the battery, or in other terms, the battery offers a resistance to the charge, which is called the internal resistance of the battery. And because of this internal resistance, when a unit positive charge reaches a positive terminal, some part of its energy, which is gained due to the work done by the non-electric force, will be consumed against the internal resistance. So if the current through the battery is I, then the energy consumed per unit charge against this internal resistance R will be capital I into R. So the energy of a unit positive charge as a positive or at the positive terminal of a battery will be less by an amount IR, which is compared to the energy when the circuit is in open condition. So net energy per unit charge will be this energy in the open circuit condition minus I into R. So during the flow of current, this energy will be called as potential difference between two terminals of a battery, or you can say it will be the terminal voltage of this battery. So V will be equal to E minus IR. This is E energy in the open circuit condition, V equal to E minus IR. Secondary cell, lead accumulator. So electrochemical cells, they are of two types. One is primary cell, the other is secondary cell. So primary cell, the cells which get discharged only are called primary cell, like the voltaic cell. Primary cell cannot be recharged. Once it is discharged, it cannot be recharged. While the secondary cells, the cells which can be restored to original condition, if you reverse the chemical processes, that is by recharging, it can be recharged, is called the secondary cells. So in this secondary cell, we can pass current in either direction, both direction. So when conventional current leaves the cell at the positive terminal and enters the cell at the negative terminal, the cell is said to be discharging. This is the normal working of the cell during the chemical energy is converted into electrical energy. But if the cell is connected to some other, say, large EMF, electromotive force, the current may enter the cell at the positive terminal and leave through the negative terminal, right? So the electrical energy is then converted into chemical energy and the cell will get charged. So the most commonly used secondary cell is our PB, lead accumulator cell. So lead accumulator, lead accumulator, it consists of electrode and, which is basically electrode, positive electrode, negative electrode. So the electrodes are made up of PbO2, and then Pb lead, which is immersed in an electrolyte of H2SO4 dilute sulfuric acid. So this PbO2, it acts as a positive electrode, and this Pb acts as a negative electrode. When the cell is in use or usage, that means the cell is being discharged, the SO4 sulfate ion, SO4 minus 2, it moves towards the Pb here electrode and give up the negative charge and forms PbSO4. The H plus ion, this breaks into H plus and SO4. So H plus and 2H plus and SO4 minus. So SO4 minus move toward the Pb electrode and give up the electron negative charge to form PbSO4. The H plus ion move to the PbO2 here. They move to PbO2 electrode and they give up the positive, these are positively charged. So they give the positive charge and reduce PbO2 to PbO, this to PbO. So the PbO, which is formed now, react with H2SO4 in order to form PbSO4 and water. So this PbSO4 lead sulfate is formed at both the electrodes, and the concentration of the electrolyte decreases with time. So the concentration of the electrolyte, which is dilute sulfuric acid, can be measured by the device. We call it as a hydrometer. And the cell, when it is fully charged, the specific gravity of electrolyte is 1.285, and EMF of a cell is about 2.1 volt. But when it is discharged, the specific gravity falls to 1.15 as against 1.285, and EMF may fall to 1.8 volt against the 2.1 volt. Charging. So to charge a secondary cell, say of EMF E, epsilon or E you can say, a DC direct current has to be passed through the cell, as you see here. So the positive terminal of the cell here is connected to positive end of the DC source. So positive is connected to the positive, and negative terminal is connected to the negative of DC supply, right? Which is opposing condition for the charging of a cell. And of course, this V battery EMF should be, or the V which is charging, or the DC supply which is charging, has to be greater than the E. And because of the chemical reaction which are occurring in this cell during the charging process, now this PbSO4 lead sulfate deposited to two electrodes, now they are dissolved. So now lead is deposited on the negative electrode and PbO2 at the positive electrode, and in the process the H2SO4 is also formed, and this will restore the capacity of the cell to provide current again. So in this case, the electrical energy, which is V into I into T, by this DC source provide E into IT energy for the charging of the cell. So we have to add these I square RT plus I square small RT. This energy is dissipated in the external series, say of resistance R, and internal resistance R. This is external resistance, this is internal resistance of the battery. So this VIT will be equal to EI to this one plus I square RT and I square small RT. This is given by DC source, and this is the EIT energy for charging a cell, and this is dissipated because of the resistances. So we can equate them. Let us take I outside this. Now you can say I can be cancelled. One I can be cancelled and one I can be taken out. So V equal to E plus I R plus R, R plus small r. So V minus E, or you can say current will be V minus E by R plus R. So this equation gives the charging current, and this resistance is connected to control the current. Six batteries, each of 2 volts, are connected in series so that they are helping each other. So they are in series. Internal resistance, that is small r, is 0.5. They are being charged using a DC or direct voltage supply of 110. So voltage is V, and this 2.0 is actually E, right? R is 0.5. To control the current, a resistance of 46 ohms, so this is capital R, is used in the series. We have to obtain the power drawn from the supply, and second, power dissipated as heat. Why are the two different? So we know that V equal to E plus IR plus IR, R small and R capital. So this, because this is for one battery, because six batteries are there, so we have to multiply it by six. And this, because there are six batteries, so six into IR, six small batteries are there. So 6 into IR plus IR. Now V is given as 110, E is given 2.0, R is also given 0.5, capital R is 46 ohm. So we can compute the current here. As we saw in the previous discussion, current can be computed by this formula, I equal to 2 ampere. Now what will be the power drawn from the supply? This will be V into I, right? So I we know, and V also we know. So power will be, or you can say work done, will be 220 volts. Now what is the power dissipated as heat? See, it will be I square into R plus I square into small r. But because of 6 batteries, we have to multiply it by 6. So 6 into I square into small r plus I square into capital R. We'll take I square outside. This is 2, so 2 square is 4. 6 into R and capital R, and this is 196 watt. Now this is the power drawn by the supply, and this is power dissipated as heat. We will subtract them. The difference is 24 volt, and the power is used to charge the batteries. Kirchhoff rules. In different and various electronic circuit components like resistors, inductors, capacitors, batteries, these are connected with each other in certain way. So such circuit cannot be considered as a simple series or parallel connection. And these are known as network. These complicated circuit where variety of things are used are called as network. So Ohm's law alone is not sufficient to analyze a network. So there are different rules we need to apply to analyze a network. So Kirchhoff's two rules are amongst them, all these rules. So we'll try to understand two terms which are concerning to the circuits before the discussion of the Kirchhoff rule. First is, what is a junction or a branch point, and then what is a loop? So junction or a branch point, the point in any network at which more than two conductors, or you can say minimum three, meet is called a junction or a branch point, right? You might have seen the railway line. In this figure, three conductors are meeting at A and B. See, A, 1, 2 and 3. B, 1, 2 and 3. So, the point A and B are called junction or branch points. Let us see what is loop. So, a closed circuit which is formed like this, it has to be a closed circuit by conductors is known as loop. As you see here, this C, D, A, B, C. And also A F, then E B A, like this. So this one, and this one, whole one. So these are some of the closed path of the conductors known as loop. So in order to analyze a network, there are unknown quantities like V, I, R, which are in a given circuit. This can be determined by the known quantities. Kirchhoff rules. So Kirchhoff first rule says that it is actually the consequence of conservation of charge only. So just consider this junction O of our network. The current meeting at the junction O are I1, this is I1, and I2, I3, I4 and I5, right? And these directions are represented by these arrows, which are coming, which are going. Let this Q1 and 2 Q5 be the electric charges flowing through the cross-sectional area of the this conductor in the time interval T, which constitute current as I1 to I5. So what is I1? I1 will be Q1 by T. You know that current is charge per unit time. So Q1 will be what? I1 into T. Q2 will be I2 T. Q likewise, Q3, Q4, Q5 will be I5 into T. So these are I1, I2, I till I5. Now from the figure it is being seen that the total charge entering the junction is what? It is 5Q, I1 is entering and I1 is entering and I3 is entering, right? So this is Q1 and Q3. So Q1 and Q3 it is entering, while this is going outside, this is going outside, this is going outside. So Q2, Q4 and Q5, this is amount of charge which is leaving the junction at the same interval of time. And as per the law of conservation of charge, the charge which is entering has to be equal to charge which is leaving. Now put in place of Q, or Q1 I1T, Q2 I2T, like this. So we have placed all this value and we equated them and just brought it here. So what we see that sigma I will be equal to 0. Summation will be 0. So the algebraic sum of all the electric current which is meeting at a junction, whether it is going or coming, is zero. And this statement is known as Kirchhoff first rule. In this sum, I1 and I3, these are positive, while I2, I4 and I5, these are negative. So the electric current entering the junction are considered as positive, and electric junction which are leaving are considered as negative. And we can also consider opposite convention, but because this is the traditional, we will use this. Kirchhoff's second rule. Using the law of conservation of energy and the concept of electric potential, any closed circuit can be easily analyzed. So Kirchhoff's second rule is the essence of the step we just saw. So let us take the closed path, which is A and B and C and D and E and then again A. This is a closed path. So we have resistor R1, R2, R3, R4, R5 and the batteries in, we have this EMF with E1 and E2 here. Two batteries with EMF E1 and E2 is here. So if the internal resistance of the battery can be ignored, the rise in the electric potential while going from negative to positive terminal of a cell is equal to the EMF of a battery, right? We are ignoring the internal ones. So the potential difference across the end of resistor is equal to the product of the resistor and the current. So V equal to IR, current and the resistor. So the electric potential at any point in a steady circuit does not change with time. It doesn't change with time. So if VA, V sub A is the electric potential, say at point A here, we say VA is electric potential at point A. So if you measure the changes in the electric potential by moving in the clockwise or anti-clockwise direction in a closed circuit and come back to that point A, this VA will remain unchanged. And this is called the single valuedness of the electric potential. And in fact, this single valuedness of the electric potential is a consequence of the law of conservation of energy only. So the electric potential now drops by I1 into R1. I1 into R1, if you move clockwise direction, like this direction from this A to the resistor R1. So the direction of current is arbitrarily we have taken from A to B. That is, current flows through this resistor R1, from a point, say, higher potential A to lower potential. Here there will be a drop in a potential which is I1 R1 as we move from A to B. And there will be a rise in the potential E1 while we go from negative terminal to the positive terminal of a battery with, say, this EMF E1, okay? Because there is E1 in between, right? So the potential rises to what? This is, we say, current I2 is here, so R2 is there. So I2, the potential rises to I2, where we go from B to C, from this point to this point, while there are a resistor R2 is there. So as the direction of current is assumed to be from C to B, we say from it is C to B, because I is coming like this. So the electric potential of point C has to be higher. This point C has to be higher than B because current is moving from C to B. So the potential rises by an amount I to R2 while going from B to C. In the similar way, there will be decrease in potential which is equal to E2 when we go from positive to negative terminal of a battery, which is now E2. Now we are taking this path from this point to this point. So there is a potential drop of, this is I3, this is R3. Potential drop of I3, R3 will be there while passing through R3. A rise in potential I4, R4 through R4. And rise in potential, this point, I5, R5 through R5. Now we'll take the algebraic sum of all these values and the potential at point A has to be same, VA. So we say VA will be what? VA minus I1 R1 plus E1, because there is a battery here, so we are adding E1, and then I2 R2 minus, because it is wherever we have known that the sign has to be taken. If this is taken as positive, this has to be taken as negative. So now this is E1 plus I2 R2. This will be minus E2 plus I3 R3 and then plus I4 R4 plus I5 R5. So this is the situation which comes when we consider where is the current going, where are the resistors, which is higher potential, which is lower potential, and the EMFs in between. So we can just rearrange them, just VAV will be cancelled, we can rearrange them. So the algebraic sum of all the charges in the potential around any closed loop will be zero. It is zero. We say this is all IR, 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 this is E1 and E2. So sigma IR will be equal to sigma of E. Sigma of E, these are all IR. So this equation is suggesting that for any closed loop like this, the algebraic sum of the product of resistances and the respective current, that is I into R flowing through them, is equal to the algebraic sum of the EMFs being applied along the loop. And this is the Kirchhoff's second rule. Here, the most important thing is the sign convention, right? So if we take the journey through the resistor is in the direction of flow of current, which we arbitrarily choose, IR should be considered negative. And if the direction of journey and the direction of current is opposite, means journey is this and current is flowing in this direction, we have to take it as negative. The EMF of a battery, EMF, electromotive force of a battery, should be considered negative while moving from negative terminal to positive terminal, while writing, on the right hand side of the equation. And the EMF of a battery, which is taken from positive while moving from positive to negative, right, to the terminal of a battery, will take it as positive. So direction of electric current we can arbitrarily choose while using this Kirchhoff rule to analyze any network. And we shall get negative value of the current if the direction of current, which is arbitrarily chosen, is actually opposite to the actual direction of current. So there is no worry. You can take any direction. If it is coming negative, that means you have started with the opposite direction. Calculate the current flowing through resistor R1 in the given circuit. R1 is given as 10 ohm, R2 is 20 ohm, R3 is 30 ohm. The potentials of point 1, 2 and 3 are given as 10 volt, 6 volt and 5 volt. We have to calculate the potential at this junction also. So this O is the junction point. See, always current flows from higher potential to lower potential, right? So this is 10 volts. So current is going to flow from this in this direction. And as it reaches here, because there are two more directions, the current will flow like this and current will flow like this. So this is how the current is going to flow. So we'll take one path as 102, the other path as 103. Okay. So 102 path is saying that we have started with 10 volt. Now there will be a voltage drop because there is a resistance. So we'll take the negative sign. V1 is 10 volt minus IR1. Say the current I is passing here. I is current passing here, so IR1 is the voltage drop. Now we are taking this path. Again, there is a voltage drop because of this resistance, so it will be minus I2. And we reach here, let us say the voltage here as V2, right? Now V1 is 10, I is not known, but R is known, 10. The other R2 is known, this 20 is known, and the final voltage is 6. So we rearrange this, and this is our first equation. Now we are going to take this path 1, 0 and 3. Here we start with 10, right? So the voltage V1 will write this one only, V1, same. Then minus, again IR1, again same thing, I into R1, that is I into 10. And now again the current is flowing like this, so there will be a voltage drop, so minus. We say that this is, if this is I and this is, say, I1, okay, this is I1. So what will this will be? I, total is I, I1 has gone here, so it will be I minus I1. So we'll use I minus I1 here into this resistance, 30. And this will be equal to what? V3. We have ultimately reached here, so voltage after dropping and etc. will be this 5 volt. So now we rearrange this, okay? This is given as, again, we'll take it as 10. So we had rearranged and we get this another equation. Now we can solve these two equations. I hope that I and I1 and I2 can be solved. And this is equal to 0.2 ampere. Now we have to find the potential at this point also. So we can take just this path. So we start with 10. This is the voltage. There is a voltage drop minus, that is why we are taking minus sign, minus I into R1, that is 10. Right? Means 10 we start it and we say I minus I into I minus R1, because the voltage is dropping here. Or you can say that there is another point you can say. This is a point and this is a point. Now when current is flowing through this, from this point to this point, we say the voltage is 10 and here the voltage is VO. Let us assume this. And what will be the difference of this? 10 minus VO will be equal to the voltage drop because of this R1. So we say I into R1, that is I into I is what? 0.2. R1 is what? 10. So this is equal to 2. So we can use this 10 minus VO. VO is the point where we have to find out the voltage. So 10 minus VO will be equal to 2. So VO or the voltage at point O will be 8 volt. Calculate the potential difference between the plates A and B of the capacitor in the adjacent circuit. So the distribution is something like this. So we'll apply the Kirchhoff's second law of closed loop. So first we'll take a closed loop, which is this one. This one, okay. So let us say that the direction of current here is I1. Here it is, because this I1, say I1 is coming like this. I1 is going like this. So we have I1 here. This is also I1. And say I, this is I current. So this is I current. Let us say this I is also coming here. And now this is a capacitor. So we are not considering this. You might be saying that the current will go there, but we are, if I1 is coming here, it will go there to the resistance. If I is coming here, it will go like this. So if I is going here, if I is coming here and I1 is going here, so what will be the current here? This will be I minus I1. Okay. So now this loop we are checking out. So we'll take a loop from in this direction. We'll take the current direction. So this will be A and B and C and D and A. So we start from here. First of all, we have this 10 into I. 10 is the resistance, I is the current. Now we move in this direction and there will be a voltage drop because we are moving in the current direction. So 20 is the resistance and I minus I1 is the current. So minus 20 I minus I1. And because of this also 10 into I, well, there will be a voltage drop. We are in the direction of the current. And what will be, because we are coming this side, so this is a negative and this is positive. So there is an increment of the voltage. Always negative to positive is the increment of voltage. So we have to take plus. And this whole, this every loop has a potential as zero, because we are starting from the from this point, ending at this point. That means the voltage will not change. So it is, the difference of voltage will be zero. So it is zero. So this is first equation. Now we will take this loop, say this loop. This loop, okay. And again, this 20 into, now we'll take this direction, 20 into I minus I1 plus, now we are moving in this direction. So there is a increment of the voltage because we are going from negative to positive terminal 1 volt. And now we are going in the direction of the current. So 30, this 30 into I1 will be the voltage drop. So it will be negative. This was positive because we are in the opposite direction of the current. This is when we are in the direction of current, there will be a voltage drop. And when we go from negative to positive, there will be always a positive value of EMF. So these two are the equation. We need to solve these two equations. We get I1 and I. Now the potential difference between the two plates of the capacitor, we are talking about this capacitor, is equal to the potential difference between the between what is there at C and H, right? So this H and C will decide what is the potential difference between them. Let us say that VC is the potential at this point, say here, at this point, and VH is the potential at this point, right? Now let us take the path CDH, this path. This path, as we see here, that this, we start from VC. We start from VC and this is the direction of current. So there will be a voltage drop from of 10 into I. I we have already known. So 10 into 0.2 in minus. Then we move in this direction. So this there will be an addition of 1 volt. So 1 volt. And when we come here, this is the VH. This was VC, VH. So VH is the point where we have reached. So this the from VC, there is a drop, there is an addition of 1 volt, and that will be equal to VH. So VC minus VH we have to find. Take this side, this VH here, take this on the other side. This VC minus VH is the potential difference between A and B, and this is equal to 1 volt. Calculate the potential difference between points A and B, as well as between points C and D under steady condition of the circuit shown in the figure. So A is this point, B is this point, and C is this point, and D, the C and B. So A and B and C and B, we have to find out the potential difference between them, right? So you say this E, we have just named them. So this is E, E, or you can say A, you can say A, and you come to D, which is this one. D are, these are the two ends of the capacitor, 3 microfarad. So if you take 3 microfarad, it is D and E are the points. In between them, this 3 microfarad is lying. And you see, this microfarad, 1 microfarad, is lying between K and F. So K and, or you can say this K and H, this 1 microfarad is lying. And between K and F, this 1 microfarad is lying. And between E and F, this 1 microfarad is lying, right? So the equivalent of this circuit can be, because we have to see what potential differences are. If you take B, if you take A, if you take E, all they have equal potential difference. So ultimately, this one and this one, they are in parallel. When we are saying this point and this point, they are at, they, this point are at same potential difference, we say this, these two are in parallel. In the same way, if you see this two, these two, H, G and F, they are having same potential difference. So if you take this point B, D and K, they are at same potential difference, these three are having same potential difference, and these three are having same potential difference. This one are in parallel, this one are in parallel. Now we redraw this figure. So BAE we have put as one point, GHF as one point, and this D and this one K and B as one point, right? Now in between them we have this 1 microfarad, and this is in, because E and F, if you see, if this is E, this is F. So now this 1 microfarad is in parallel with these two. So we are putting it as a parallel. I hope you got this idea why we have done this. And rest, our circuit remains the same. Okay. So there are 2-3 microfarad capacitor which are in parallel. So what will be them? The addition of this 3-3, so it will be 6. Now 1 microfarad, what will be the value? It will be 1 and 1, which is equal to 2 microfarad. So the equivalent of this will be 6, the equivalent of these two will be 2 microfarad. So this is how it is shown. And since the circuit is in steady state, no current flows through this 20 ohm and 10 ohm resistances. So it seems as if these resistors are not connected in the circuit. In this scenario, the voltage of the battery, which is 100 volt, is applied between point A and point H. So this 6 microfarad and 2 microfarad, these are again connected in series. And these two are connected in series. This one and this one, the equivalent are connected in series. And the resultant will be connected in parallel. Let us see. The 6 and 2, they are in series. So how to, if this 6 and 2 are in, say, we have an equal charge, because equal charge is passing, because they are in series. So we can say the potential V, equivalent potential will be equal to say V1 and V2. What is V1? V1 will be Q by C1. The charge flowing is same. So V2 will be Q by C2, and this is V. But the potential is 100. So write V as 100, Q by 6 plus Q by 2 equal to 100, Q is the 150 microcoulomb. Now the potential difference between point A and point B is equal to the voltage which is developed across what, which capacitor? This 6 microfarad capacitor, right? From this point to this point, there is only 6 microfarad. So there is a potential A and B. That means what is the potential between on 6 microfarad? So what is the potential V equal to? We have got the charge. We divide by 6. It will be 25 volt. Okay. So what will be the voltage between now B and C? Total was 100. It is 25 here. So what will be the difference from this point to this point? It will be 100 minus 25, which is 75 volt. A cube is made by connecting 12 wires of equal resistance R. So a cube is 12 wires of equal resistance R. Find the equivalent resistance between any two of its diagonally opposite point. Any two. You can take these two. You can take these two, any of these, and the value will remain same. Now you have to see here that let us assume that I current is, we have said I current, and this is coming through this cell. And this path, this AB, if I is current is coming here, this path AB, this path AD, and this path AA dash. These are symmetrical, right? So if I is passing, if this is a cube, it's a symmetrical path. So if I is coming here, I by 3 will go here, I by 3 will go here. These three are, if you add I by 3, it will be I1. Now we come to the junctions, which are this B, because the current has reached here, the current has reached here, and their current has reached here, the incoming current. So incoming current is I by 3 at this point, I by 3 at this point, and I by 3 at this point. Again, because of symmetry, see, D has 2 outgoing, so I by 3 will be divided into 2, so I by 6 will go here, I by 6 will go here. In the similar fashion, because there are two paths, because of this, there are two points, and because of symmetry, this I3 will be divided into half, so I6 will go here, I6 will go here. Similarly, at A dash, I6 will go here, I6 will go here. Okay, so this is how the things are going. And when you see at the junction C, let us come at this point C and the point B dash, which is, and the point D dash. So this is D dash. At this point, the current, they are reuniting. That means the I6 is coming from this side, the I6 is coming from this side, so it will be I3 here. Again at C dash, I3 is coming from this side, I3 is coming from this side, so it will be I by 6. Okay, so this is how we get I3 from here, I3 from here, I3 from here. Ultimately, they I3 plus I3 plus I3 will be I. So this is the whole formation. Okay, now let us apply Kirchhoff's loop. We can use some closed loop, and we can apply the Kirchhoff's second rule. So let us take this A dash. Then we can take this D dash. Then C dash, right? Then M, N, L, again to A, this point. We have started from A, so we have to go like this. This path I'm taking, like this. Okay? So now, we are moving in the direction of current, right? So it will be I by 3, first point, I by 3 into R. There will be a drop of voltage. Now at this point it will be minus, again we are in the direction of current, so it will be drop, voltage drop, I by 6 into R. The R is same for all. At this point it will be again R into I by 3, and then we are coming here, and because this is negative to positive, it will be plus E. So we can this plus E. So plus, because negative to positive means the EMF or the voltages is increased. So now we can either plus E here, or we can take E here on the right hand side. So this EME will be equal to, we'll add all these, this will be 5 by 6 IR. Now let us assume that the equivalent resistance between two diagonally opposite points, say let us take A and this C dash, these are diagonally opposite. Let us say to be some R dash, right? So that it means that if R dash is connected across the same battery, say this E, in place of the given network, the situation would be something like this. This is E. From this point, it is R dash. And the points are A and C dash. So we have taken point as A and this as C dash. This is equivalent. So now what we get here, I is coming. This is say R dash. So EMF will be equal to I into R dash. But we know we found this EMF as 5 by 6 IR. This is equal to IR dash. What will be R dash? II cancels. R dash will be 5 by 6 of R. A cube is constructed by connecting 12 wires of equal resistance, which is shown here. We have seen just a question like this now. Find the equivalent resistance between point A and B, that is this point A and this point B. Now it is in between this. The resistance of each wire is R ohm. A and B are the midpoints of side PQ. This is the midpoint of side PQ and B is the midpoint of U and B. Okay. So we have to see here that with the reference to the line joining point A and B, there will be pairs. First is this AP pair, ANP pair, and UB pair, this U and B. And these are pairs. AQ means from this point to this point, AQ, and we have VB, this and this. So this one and this one will be a pair. We again have PW and RU. P and W, this one, and RW, that means this RU. PW and RU, these are pairs. Again, QT, this Q and T, this one, and SV, which is our, this is equivalent to S and V, which is opposite. These lines are opposite. Again, WV, which is this one, W and V, is opposite to T and U. So these are all pairs. These are pairs and these are symmetric branches. So the current flowing through each of this symmetric pair must be same. So if we say the current which is flowing through this PW is I by 4. First, let me tell you that if some I current is coming here, it will be divided equally. I by 2 will go this side, I by 2 will come this side. Now, because this is symmetric, I by 2 is coming. So this side it will go I by 4, this side it will go I by 4. And in the same fashion, I by 4 is coming here, right? Similarly, if at this point, I by 4 is going here, because half I by 2 is coming here, so I by 4 is going here, I by 4 is going here. And this I by 4 and this I by 4, because at some point they are adding also, they are getting added also. So we see, because of the symmetric pairs, if the current flowing through this PW is I by 4, the current which is at RU, that means if PW is this one, I by 4, then we don't need to find out any other current, by whether it is dividing or not. We can simply say that if this is I 4, this will also be I by 4. And with this consideration, the proportional currents through the various circuits can be assigned. This is I by 2, this is I by 2, this is I by 2, this is I by 2. This is I by 4, this is I by 4. Like this. This is I by 4, this is I by 4. See? This is I by 4, this is I by 4. This is how we, and this is I by 2, I by 2. This is I by 4. This is I by 2 plus I by 2. So you can just see that if both currents are coming here, so this can also be seen like this. So now point W, this W, and T, these are symmetric. This point W and T are symmetric. This point and this point we are talking about. About A. These are at the same potential. So no current will flow through WT. We might have thought that, okay, if this I by 4 is coming, I by 8 will go here, I by 8 will go here. No, not like that. Because W and T are at the same potential about A. See, at this point, these two are having same potential. So there will be no flow of current through WT. This line will have no current. Similarly, SR, this will also have no current. So we will not assign any current here, will not assign current here. So I by 4 which is coming will go directly like this. If I by 4 is coming like this, it will go directly like this. There will be no current here, there will be no current here. So now we'll apply the Kirchhoff's second rule to a closed surface, a cold closed loop, which is, we start with A. This is A, then P, then W, then V, then B, then N, then M, then again to A. So let us see what is happening. If we are moving in the direction of current, there will be a wave voltage drop, so we'll be writing negative. So first is minus I2 into R by 2. This is minus I2 into R by 2. Resistance is half. This is whole is R. This resistance will be R by 2. This is I by 2 into R by 2. Then we are taking this path. So this is I by 4 and R is the resistance. Voltage drop will be there. Again in the direction of current, this is I by 4 and R is the resistance. Now we go to this I by 2. And since whole is R, this will be R by 2. So I by 2 into R by 2, again voltage drop. And what will be this? We are going from negative to positive, so we have to add plus E here. So we'll take this plus, and this will be equal to 0. But we are taking this plus E, this side, so it will be minus E. So what we get? If you combine this, you get IR equal to E. If the equivalent resistance say is R dash, we say I into R dash equal to E. We equate these two, R dash will be equal to exactly equal to R. So resistors, we can arrange them in order of series or parallel. So resistors can be connected in series or parallel, or series or parallel together, that is combination of both the types between any two point. So we have already seen the series and parallel connections of resistor. Here we are going to talk about the results and more combinations. So series combination of resistors are said to be connected in series between any two point if the same current, see this I is going to this resistor, and this only current is coming out. So same current is passing through R1, R2, R3 and Rn. So if the same current is flowing through each resistor, there is only one path available for the flow of current. So this figure, it shows R1 to Rn, and we know that the equivalent resistance is given by Rs, Rs given by R1 till Rn. So we write sigma 1 to n, and this is Ri, R sub I varies from 1 to n. So the equivalent resistance of the series combination of resistor is always greater than the greatest value of the resistor. So whichever is the greatest value, the equivalent resistor will be higher than the greatest one. So if n identical resistor, each of R are connected, you can replace R1, R2, R3, Rn by R. So this will be, if there are n identical resistor, the total resistance will be n into R. Parallel connection of resistors. So when these resistors are connected in parallel, that is, if they are between, they are connected such that they are between two points and there are more than one path available for flow of current. So the current I, it divides into I1, I2 till In, right? And the potential difference, that is point A, point B, the VA and VB, if these are potential, VB minus VA is identical for all these resistors, right? Potential difference remains the same. So here we have n resistors, say from R1 to Rn, and the equivalent resistance 1 by Rp, this is for parallel, is given by 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 till 1 by Rn. And this is sigma I equal to 1 to n, 1 by Ri. 1 by Ri, R sub I, this I varies from 1 to n. So the equivalent resistance of a parallel combination of resistor is always smaller. It will be always smaller than the smallest value of resistor connected in parallel. So if any of these is smaller, smallest of all the resistor, the equivalent resistance will be even smaller than that. So if n identical resistor, they having resistance R, are connected in parallel, so equivalent resistance will be 1 by Rp will be 1 by R, 1 by R, 1 by R, add n times, so it will be n by R. So we have to revert it. We have to take the reciprocal to find Rp, that is R equivalent resistance, which are parallel. So this will be capital R by N. So this figure, the first figure we are taking, some current flows through resistors R1, R2, and R3. R1 is given as 10 ohm, R2 is given as 20 ohm, and R3 is given as 30 ohm. And the battery voltage is equal to 10 volt, right? So we have to find out what will be the current. So see, let us first start with this point A. We have to find out the equivalent circuit, because this is not an equivalent circuit. We have to find either it is in parallel or either they are in series. So we have to find an equivalent circuit first. So here one end of this resistor is connected to point A, and the other is end of the resistor R2. See, this R2 is connected to this point C. So A and C, in between this we have R1 and R2, and so the circuit can be reassembled, because this A and C can be combined, because these two can be combined. So A and C point can be combined, and if you see that this R1 becomes R1 and R2, these are parallel to each other. Similarly, for the other end of the resistor R1, see this B, and this R2 and R3, these are connected to point B. See, this is the end which is connected to B. R1 is also connected to B. So what we can deduce is, we can combine this B and D. So when we combine this B and D, in between this B and D we have R2 and R3. So these two are in parallel. From first discussion, R1 and R2 were in parallel. From second discussion, R2 and R3 are in parallel. That means R1 and R3 are also in parallel. So R1, R2, R3, they are in parallel. Okay. Now if say I current is passing, let us say that I1, I2 and I3 are the current through R1, R2 and R3. So what will be the current flowing? I1 will be equal to V by R1, right? Voltage is given as 10, R is our 10. So for the first one, it will be 10 by 10. Second will be 10 by 20, 20 is the resistance 2, 30 is the resistance 3, voltage remains the same. So these are the current R1, R2, R3 is passing through. An electric current 5 ampere is divided into 3 branches forming a parallel combination. So there is a parallel combination. The length of the wire in the 3 branches are in the composition. So L1, L2, L3, means L1 is to L2 is to L3 is 2 is to 3 is to 4. See? And their radii are in the ratio or proportion 3 is to 4 is to 5. So one is 2L, the other is 3L, the third one will be 4L. Similarly, for radius it is given as 3, 4, 5. So one is 3R, the other is 4R, and the third one will be 5R. These are the ratio being given. We know that R is equal to rho L upon A. So these are the respective resistances, right? So R equal to rho L upon A. First of all, we'll use L1 and A1. So L1 is, we can use 2L, and A is, we know that for area we have to use pi R square, and this is the radii 3R. So we'll use pi into 3R whole square. So L will be 2L in the first case, and area will be pi 3R square. So we'll put it here. Similarly, R2 will put 3L and 4R square. For R3 we'll put 4L and pi into 5R square. Now the ratio of, because the ratio can be easily found out, this is 2 by 9, this is 3 by 16, and this is 4 by 25. So R1 is to R2 is to R3 is 2 is to 9, 3 by 16 and 4 is to 25. We know that V equal to Ri. Okay. So R, you can say R equal to V by I. So if resistance are in this ratio, what will be I? I will be in opposite ratio. So R is 2 by 9. So I1 is to R2, I2 is to I3 will be 9 is to 2, 16 is to 3 and 25 is to 4. So these will be the value. Okay. And we could just multiply them by a suitable number so that we can remove the denominator. So you can take the LCM of this and multiply it. And now the I1 can be found out. I1 is simply this V1 by this value, right? R rho L upon A you can find out. And this I2 can be also find out. And I3 can also be found out. We have various relationship between them, because I and R ratio is known, and the when I and R ratio is known, you can just multiply this 54 and into 5 by 193, because this is the total, right? And this is the current you can obtain. Series and parallel connections of cells. So like the resistors, these cells also can be connected in series or parallel, or you can combine them, you know. In one circuit, you can have parallel and series combination both. So when cells are in series, suppose we have two cells, say we have first having EMF E1, second having EMF E2, and the internal resistance of this cell is say R1, and this is R2. They are connected in series. Series, that is the current passing through both of them are same. So an external resistance, this R, this external resistance R is also connected across the connection. So we'll apply the Kirchhoff rule. So if we say the current, because current will take this direction, right, and we'll move in the ABCDA direction, means A, B, C, D, A. So when we go here, it is coming, see, it is from higher to lower. So we'll get this E1 in negative. We are going from higher potential to lower potential, so we have to take negative. And because we are moving in opposite direction to the current, so this will be positive, right? I into R1. Then again, for the same reason, this will be minus E2. And we are move for this one, we are moving in the opposite direction of current, so we have to take plus I into R2. That is, there will be voltage up, not drop. And as we are moving in the opposite direction of this I into R, again, this has to be IR. And this whole will be equal to zero. In a closed loop, the voltage or the potential difference between the same point, if you take a loop, it will be zero. So take E1 and E2 on this side, take I common. So I will be equal to E1 plus E2 by R1, R plus small r1 plus R2. So what we have got here is, this is the equivalent EMF and this is the equivalent resistance, internal resistance. And I is the current which is passing through the resistor. So this series combination of two cells, this act as a single cell. So if you combine two cells in series, the equivalent, you can assume it to be a single cell, E1 plus E2. And internal resistance, this has R1, this is R2. So you can also say that the equivalent resistance is R. So in this sense, E equivalent is equal to you can say E equivalent is equivalent EMF, and R equivalent is the equivalent resistance if you connect the cells in the series. But if the polarity of one of the cells is reversed, then the EMF will be E1 minus E2. But the equivalent resistance, internal resistance, will not change. It will be R1 plus R2 only. Means if you combine like this, this is E1, this is E2, the resultant will be E1 minus E2. Okay, and the modulus of this. But resistance R1, R2, because resistance is already there, always there. For current, if current is passing, the resistance will be there itself. So R1 plus R2 will remain as, whether you connect it like this or in this similar polarity or in opposite polarity. Now the cells, when we put it in parallel. So this is one cell, this is two cell, and this is, these are kept in parallel, and we have a outer resistance, right? So suppose we have two cells, this is having E1 and E2 are the EMFs, internal resistance is R1 and R2. The current is like this. See, if you see I is passing through like this, then I will divide into I1 and I2, and I1 will pass through this, I2 will pass through this. So we want to find the current which is flowing through this external resistor. So we'll apply the Kirchhoff rule easily, because we know that I will be equivalent to I1 plus I2, right? And this will be our first equation. Now we can apply the Kirchhoff second rule for two loops. First will be our, see, this is A, D, and R, and C, and B, and first we'll take this E1, right? Means this will be our first loop. and then we have second loop A, D, R, C, B. Now this loop we are going to take, this loop. So two loops we are going to take. So first we'll apply the Kirchhoff law to the first loop. So there will be, we are moving in the direction of current. Okay, so this is, let us start from here. We are moving in the direction of current, so we'll be I into R voltage drop. Then we are coming here. I1 is, we are in the direction of current. So I1 R1 will be voltage drop. So minus I1 R1. For this, we had already taken this. And since we are going from negative to positive, there is increase in the potential. So it will be plus E1 and this will be equivalent to 0. Similarly, for the other one also, we'll find out the same scenario, but here we will take E2. And from this, if you see, if we take I1, if you want to find I1, we take all other things on the right hand side, we get I1 equal to E1 minus IR1, IR by R1. For the second one, we get I2 equal to, similarly, this is replaced by E2, IR by, this will be replaced by R2. So we have I1 and I2. Now, the first equation was what? I was equal to, this I is equal to I1 plus I2. So I was equal to I1 plus I2. Let us put I1 and I2 we just found on in the previous discussion. That means this I1 and this I2 we have to put. So when you put it here and just rearrange them, right? We just need to rearrange in order to find I. So I will be equal to, this will be the final reason. Fine. So it will be I equal to E1 R2 plus E2 R1 by R1 plus R2 plus R1 R2. We are just rearranging it. So what we get? When we divide the numerator and denominator, we have this R1 plus R2. So we can just divide numerator and denominator by R1 plus R2. So we can divide this and we get this as the equivalent EMF R plus, and this is our equivalent resistance when they are in parallel. Please understand, we are talking about parallel. When the resistances are in parallel, that means you get 1 by R equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 like this. So in the parallel combination of cells, it acts as a single cell whose EMF is given by this, E equivalent is given by this whole value. So it is E1 R1 plus E2 R2 by R1 plus R2. And what will be the internal resistance? Internal resistance is given by R1 R2 R1 plus R2. Because we know that R equivalent, 1 by R equivalent is simply 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. And you can take this, the ratio of this two equation, this equation, 3.11.8 and 3.11.9, and you can easily find out E by R. This is E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2. So if the EMFs of two cells are E1, E2, if you say that they are equal and R1, R2 are also R, we simply get E, this EMF equivalent will be equal to E, means total of this, and R equivalent will be simply R by 2. Okay. So we have joined, I'll just show you some more figure regarding this. And here what we have done, see, we have joined the positive terminal at point A, and similarly, that if you see the two negative plates at point B, so the current I1 and I2 flow through the positive terminal. But if the negative terminal of the second is connected to positive terminal to the first, right? This is a scenario, but I'm just saying that we are just changing it. We are just changing. I just want to reverse the polarity. Then we would still get E2 only as we just have to put E2 equal to minus E2, right? Because the situation is like this. If you convert it like this, right? So only the EMF will be negative, because ultimately what we have done is we have followed the Kirchhoff rule, and if we just change the polarity, it will be according to that. So if there are n cells of EMF E1, E2 and En, and internal resistance are R1 to Rn, their connection in parallel, the combination is equivalent to a single cell which has EMF which is equivalent and internal resistance is R equivalent. So 1 by R equivalent is given by 1 by R, 1 by R2 till 1 by Rn. And if you have already seen that E equivalent by R equivalent is given by E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2, and I was given by sigma Ei by Ri 1 plus R sigma 1 by Ri. I varies from 1 to n, here also 1 to n. So if n cells of E1, EMF E1 to EN, resistances R from RN, internal resistance, they are connected in series to form a row, and we have M such row. So if we have one row, like if we have certain N rows, there are N here, and we have from this point to this point, we have M such rows. They are connected in parallel. These are in series, N are in series, and we have M such rows. These are in series. These are in series. So we have M such rows. If this kind of connection is there, this is a mixed combination, then I will be equivalent to sigma, this EI, R plus 1 by M, sigma RI. This capital R is the external resistance across this mixed form of connection, because we have series also. This series and these series, they are in parallel. So they are number of parallel lines like this. So what will be the equivalent? Equivalent, the current passing through will be this value. M is the number of rows, N is the number of cells in a row. And of course, R is the external resistance which is connected to the mixed connection. In the circuit which is shown here, E1 is equal to 3 volt, E2 is equal to 2 volt, and E3 is 1 volt. The resistance R1, R2, R3, they are 1 ohm. Find the current through each branch and potential difference between the point A and B. So in this case, let us assume that this I is passing through from A to B is passing through. Now I1, I2 and I3, this I1, see the directions are like this. I1 is this current, I2 is this current and I3 is this current. Okay. From the Kirchhoff law, if you take this point, I1 will be equal to I2 plus I3. Okay. And the I1, I2, I3 are there. Resistances are R1, R2 and R3. Now, first we have applied a junction rule, Kirchhoff first rule to junction A. This junction A says that the current is going from this, at this point, current is coming here. One current is coming and two currents are leaving. So I1 will be equal to I2 plus I3. This is our first equation. Now we'll apply the Kirchhoff's second rule to loops. First we'll take the loop as A and then B. You can take B and C and D, and then you can take E and F and A. So complete one we are taking, right? So if we take I1, R1, we are moving in this direction. So there will be, or you can say, let us move in ABC direction. So let us move in this direction. So now we are in opposite direction. So there will be a I1, R1 addition. Then because this is positive to negative, there is a drop, but the drop will be taken as minus E1. And then we are coming here, it is increasing. So minus to positive will be positive. And once you are in the opposite direction, you have to add it, right? And we can just rearrange and you will get this one. But we can take one more loop, which is ABCDEFA. ABCDA you can take, ABCDA. This whole you can take one, and this whole you can take, right? So from both these, we get the second one, I1, R1 minus, because now E1 and E3 are coming. So E1 and E3 was this one, which I explained you. Now E1 and E2 you can also take. It will be similar. I1, R1, then E1, because the voltage is dropping. And then it is increasing, so E2. And then there is an increment of I2, R2, because you are in the opposite direction. So it will be like this. So when we combine these two equations, this E1 minus R1 will be equal to E2 plus IR2 will be equal to E3 plus IR3. And we know that I1 was equal to I2 plus I3. This was our first junction equation. So after this 3 and 4, if you see E1 minus in this I1, you can write I2 plus I3. So we have placed I2 plus I3 here and this remains here. So you get 2 I3 plus I2 equal to 2. Also, we can use this to second equation. So you get E2 plus I2 R2 equal to E3 plus I3 R3. And you can just say, rearranging this, you get I3 minus I2 equal to 1. So you have one this equation, second this equation, so and one more equation like this. So you can just solve I1, I2 and I3, I1 is 1 ampere, I2 is 0 ampere, I3 is 1 ampere, right? This is how we can find out the current. Now, potential difference between A and B will be what? The potential difference between A and B is simply potential difference between A and D. These are same, right? So, the potential difference between A and D is given by, this is, see, E1 minus I1 R1. We are taking this path. So, E1 minus IR1, you can take this also. No worries about that. You can take this also. Any of these you can take. E1 minus I1 R1. So, E1 is 3. I1 we just found out as 1 ampere and R1, this resistance is 1. So, this is 2 volt. Wheatstone bridge. In 1843, Charles Wheatstone, he developed a circuit in order to measure unknown resistance and with a reference to standard known resistor. So, we have a standard known resistance. With respect to that, he was able to know the value of an unknown resistor, and this circuit was known as Wheatstone bridge. So, this Wheatstone bridge network is like this. The bridge has 4 resistor arms. This is R1, R2, R3 and R4, and they are forming a closed loop. The source of EMF is connected to A. See, this is the EMF source. It is connected to A, which is common point of R1 and R3, and C, which is common point of R2 and R4, right? And there is a sensitive galvanometer in between here. There is a galvanometer which is connected to point B and D, okay? And B is the common point. B is the common point of R1 and R2, and D is the common point of this R3 and R4. So, 3 resistors out of 4 are known and 4th one is unknown, right? So, the 3 resistors are chosen in such a way that the galvanometer shows 0 reflection right now. So, in this condition, the potential at point B and D are same because there is no movement of the galvanometer. There is no flow of current. So, this condition of Wheatstone bridge is a balanced condition right now. So, when we apply the Kirchhoff rule, we can take loop like AB, DA. So, we are taking A, B and then D and A. So, what we will do here is, we are moving in the current direction I1 into R1, there will be a drop. Then we are coming to this side, there will be an addition. The current is going like this, so there will be I2 into R2 because we are moving in the opposite direction. So, it will be addition. So, I1 R1 equal to I2 R3. Now, we'll take B, C, D, and B. So, when we are taking B, C, D, B, we are moving in the direction of the current. So, there will be a voltage drop because of R2. So, minus I1, R2, minus sign. Then we are moving in the opposite direction of current. So, there will be plus I2, R4. So, when we take this on the right hand side, I1, R2 will be equal to I2, R4. Now, these two equations we will divide. So, we get R1 by R2 equal to R3 by R4. And by knowing 3 resistors, if we know any 3 resistor, 4th can be easily found out. Meter bridge. This is a very simple practical device which is based on a Wheatstone bridge. And this is also known to know or to find out the resistance experimentally. And this is what is an example of meter bridge generally used in laboratory. So, meter bridge consists of a constant 10 wire of length 1 meter. There is a wire of length 1 meter and a uniform cross section area which is used in place of resistor R3 and R4. We have resistor because in Wheatstone bridge we have R1, R2, R3, R4. But here in place of R3, R4, we are taking a uniform cross section area, right? Length of wire, 1 meter length of wire. Okay. This wire is stretched taut very fine and clamped to on a meter scale, which is mounted on a wooden platform. And there are 2 thick copper strips which are bent at right angles. These are bent at right angles. They are connected at 2 ends, this end and this end, A and C, this end and this end of the wire. The connecting terminals are provided on this metallic strip at the end point of the wire when the battery is connected. So, when the battery is connected, there is a point through which it can be connected. So another copper strip is fixed between two thick copper strip in such a way that the metallic strip has two gaps. This has two gaps. It has two gaps across which the resistor can be connected. So R1 and R2 are connected here. One end of the sensitive galvanometer is connected to the copper strip midway. Here copper strip midway means this is the copper strip midway at a point B. See, this point is B, and between the two gaps. Okay. The other end of the galvanometer is connected to this point D, which is called a jockey, which can slide over the wire to make electric connection. So you can just slide it over, and this was the wire we were talking about, 1 meter wire. So as you see here in this figure, unknown resistance will, I'll show you the formation of this also. So here the unknown resistance, which is R1, is connected across one of the gaps, and a standard known resistor, which is R2, is connected across the other gap. So these were two gap. This is unknown, this is known. So let one of the known resistor, which is our R2, the jockey is slided along this wire. This galvanometer jockey, which is connecting to this wire, is moved. Say it is moved to point D, where the galvanometer will show no current. That means R1, R2 and these two points, which were previously in Wheatstone bridge, it was R3 and R4, they are balanced. Point D is called the balance or null point. So now let the jockey, distance of the jockey from say point A, at the balanced point, this AD is L1. From here to here it is L1. And length of the wire DC is, from here to here it is L2. So now we know that R1 by R2, this R1 by R2 is given by the resistance of wire, which is AD, and resistance of wire, which is DC. So we know that R equal to rho L upon A, we can use this. So R1 by R2 is simply given by L1 rho and L2 rho. Rho, because this is the same wire, so rho remains the same. So R1 by R2 is equivalent, or is in proportion to the length L1 and L2. This R1 by R2 will be equivalent to this L1 by L2. Rho is the resistance per unit length of the wire. So if we have known that it is 1 meter, so one is, if L1 is L1, then the other will be 100 centimeter. If we take, it will be 100 minus L1. So L2 will be 100 minus L1. So we can easily find out R1 taking R2 here. This will be R1 equal to R2 L1 by 100 minus L1. And we can just choose various values of this resistance R2, the value of L1 and L2. We can calculate each time an average value of unknown resistance, which is our R1. So this method is quite accurate, and this method gives accurate value of unknown resistance R1, but the method is not useful for the measurement of very small resistances. Calculate the current through the BC wire from this circuit shown. So this is B and this is C. So we have to find out current through BC wire. So this Kirchhoff law easily can be used, right? We'll just redraw this circuit in different way. This, the four points, which is A, B and C and D, these are common to two different resistances. We'll start with A. At point A, one end of the resistance 1 and 4. See, this one resistance, one number resistance and four number resistance, these two are connected to A. Okay. A 100 ohm resistance is connected between B and C. Resistance 200 is connected between C and D. So our 200 resistance present between this B and D, which is this one, B and D, which is this one, sorry, this one, B and D, is resistance 5. So we can just, knowing the points between which these resistances are, we can just rearrange it, right? We can rearrange it because A point is this. We have 100 and this 100. So 100 is connected. Now this B and point C, there is internal 100, and thus this 200 and 200, these, because D has is a common point for 200 200, so 200 200 will be there. So this is the actual formation. Okay, so now in this circuit, a 10 volt battery is connected. This is a 10 volt battery between this point A and D, as you see here. So we have formed a closed loop when we go from A to B to D and C and back to A. So it's a loop. So a battery is connected between this A and D, which is 10 volt. Under this balanced condition, this is a Wheatstone bridge. Okay, no current will flow from B to C. There'll be no current because this is a balanced situation. And we know that current is not passing, because R1 by R2, 100 by 100 will be equal to 200 by 200. Okay, R1 by R2 will be equal to R4 by R3. So 100 by 200 is equal to 100 by 200. So this is equal, right? So no current will flow between B and C because this is a Wheatstone bridge. And in Wheatstone bridge, we know if the ratio of these two and the ratio of these two are equivalent, then there is no current which is passing through here. So there will be no current here. ohm resistor is connected to one of the gaps of meter bridge. Series combination of X ohm and 50 ohm resistors is connected in the second gap. Here unknown resistance X ohm is kept in a heat bath at certain temperature. Calculate the unknown resistance and its temperature if the balance point is obtained at 50 centimeter. The total length of the wire of the meter bridge is 1 meter. The resistance of the unknown resistor at 0 degree temperature is equal to 100 ohm. Alpha is given 0.5 into 10 to the power minus 3 for the material of the X ohm resistor. Here we just have to use one thing, because it's a meter bridge, the resistance 1 by resistance 2 will be equal to L1 by L2. Okay, so resistance 1 is given as 200. Resistance 2, one is 50, one is X, so we will just add them, 50 plus X. L1 L2, because it is 50, it is balanced, so 50 by 50. Okay, R1 is 200, right? R2 is X plus 50, and L1 by L2, because one is 50, so the other will be 100 minus 50, that is 50. So we get X from here as 150 ohm. Now we know our equation, which is X is equal to X naught 1 plus alpha theta minus 0. This is at 0 degree. So one is theta, other is 0 degree. So this X is 150, which we just found. X0 was 100 as given in the question, right? It is 100, which is 100 ohm. 1 plus 5, this is alpha, theta minus 0 is theta. So we have to find out theta. Theta comes to be 100 degree centigrade. Potentiometer. What is the potentiometer? First of all, let us see the requirement of potentiometer. Potentio, it leads to potential. Meter means calculating or measuring something. So we have already seen for a battery, the terminal voltage was V equal to E minus IR. E was the EMF of the battery, R was the internal resistance of that battery. In this figure, if this voltmeter is used in lab, say table voltmeter, which is across two terminals A and B of a battery, this is a battery, then it will measure the potential difference between these two points A and B, right? Or two terminals of a battery, or a terminal voltage, you can say V. So this equation reduces to V equal to E. Why? If the internal resistance is zero, if this part is zero, V is equal to E, right? Or you can say that when there is no current, I is zero. When there is no current through the battery, I equal to zero, then V will be exactly equal to the EMF of the battery. But the internal resistance can never be zero. There will always be some internal resistance. So this voltmeter will measure the EMF of a battery only if no current is drawn, because R cannot be zero. It will always be there. So if there is no current, then only we can say that it is going to measure. That means if I is equal to zero, current is not flowing, that means it's an open circuit. So the resistance of an ordinary voltmeter is approximately in the range of 5000 ohm to 6000 ohm. This is the resistance of ordinary voltmeter. So a small amount of current which flows through the battery when connected to a voltmeter. So this means that voltmeter measure only the terminal voltage and not the EMF of the battery.
it will measure, the voltmeter is going to measure only the terminal voltage, not the EMF, right? So we want to measure the EMF also, EMF of battery. So we need to design a new device, new instrument, in which the open circuit condition I equal to 0 needs to be achieved. And this device is exactly called as potentiometer. This is what we are discussing. So potentiometer is that device in which we can obtain continuously varying potential difference between any two points which can be measured simultaneously, right? So what is the principle of potentiometer? In this figure, a battery of EMF E, this is battery of EMF E, and it is having internal resistance, this is R, connected in series with the resistance box RB. This is a resistance box having a resistance R and a very long resistive wire of uniform cross-sectional area. So this is a long wire, you know, this is all long wire. So we have to note that the resistance box R is not always necessary to connect, it is an option. So if in potentiometer, a long piece of uniform wire few meters in length across which his battery is connected is clamped on a meter scale. This is very important, which is mounted on a wooden platform. It's just not lying there. So there is a formation. So let us assume that the length L of the length of the potentiometer wire AB from this point is L meter. Right? It's L meter. And rho is the resistance per unit length of that wire. So what will be the resistance of wire? If rho is resistance per unit length, what will be resistance? Rho into L, we are talking that, we are saying that capital L is the length. So L into rho will be the resistance. So if R is the resistance of the resistance box, this RB, then the current flowing through wire AB can be easily found out by Ohm's law, right? V equal to IR, E equal to IR. So I is this is EMF. And the total resistance is this resistance RB plus L rho of this wire and then this small R. So this whole L is the small L, if you take, this is the whole current. Now let us take small L. This is the length of the wire from A to C, means from this point, this is small L. This point to this point, small L. And L rho, because if capital L rho is the resistance of the wire AB, then small L rho will be the resistance of this part, small part, AC. So potential difference between AC will be what? I by rho, right? So the potential difference is, if you denote it by VL, A and C, it is given by IL rho. This is IL rho, sorry. This is I into L into rho. Why? Because this is resistance. When we multiply it by I, then we get V, that is what why we are saying, VL for this length equal to I into L into rho. Now let us substitute the value of I from this equation to this equation. So we are putting I as this into this equation. So we get this. So ultimately all these are known, these are fixed. When we take the length, if you vary the length, that means the potential is directly proportional to the length, because this is constant, these values are known to us. So this potential at for some length, say AC or any length you can take, it is the directly proportional to the length L. Now we come to the principle. As we saw the discussion, the potential difference between any two points of the potentiometer wire, say VL, is directly proportional to the distance between that two points. And when we take different L, or different potential difference can be obtained. Point A to C of the wire, as we saw, behave as that they, if they are positive or negative terminals of a battery. If you change it to the position C with the help of a jockey, the EMF of a battery can be varied. So this sigma, this is potential per unit length, and when we put the value, we get this equation. So the potential difference per unit length of the wire, which is V L, V sub L by L, is sigma. This is called the, this is known as the potential gradient. V L is potential per unit length, is the potential gradient, which is, it is given in volt per meter. So the sensitivity of the potentiometer depends on the potential gradient of that wire along the wire, you can say. So smaller the potential gradient, that means greater will be the sensitivity of the potentiometer. For any given VAB, which potential from A to B, the sensitivity of potentiometer can be increased if you increase the length of the potential wire, and thereby you can decrease also by decreasing the length. What are the uses of this potentiometer? We can compare EMFs of two cells. Let us take an example. This E1 and E2, these are the EMFs of two cells which are to be compared using the or employing the potentiometer. For this job, the EMF E of the driver cell, that is the main battery here in potentiometer, should be greater than this E1 and this E2. And this has to be determined. So, if you see this figure, firstly the positive terminal of a cell E1, this is connected to end A of the potentiometer wire, and the negative of this E1 is connected to jockey through a sensitive galvanometer. Right? Like this. We will do it for E2 also. So now the jockey is moved along the wire AB. This is whole wire AB. We can just take it here, anywhere you can take along the wire till the galvanometer shows no deflection. Let us assume that the position is C1, where there is no current, no flow of current. So in this condition, no current is flowing through this cell E1. Therefore, its terminal voltage is equal to the, it will be equal to its EMF. Terminal voltage, that is V, will be equal to E only, because V equal to E minus IR, there is no current, so V will be equal to E. So, here in this case, it is E1. So, terminal voltage is equal to E1. Now, such a point on the wire, we call it as a null point. Let us suppose that the null point, this C1, is at say distance L1 from point A. From this point to this point, this length is, from this point to this point, it is L1 from A. So, if it is a balanced condition, the potential difference between this A point and C1 point of the wire should be equal to the EMF of cell, say, this E1, because we are saying that the current is not flowing. We have come to a point through jockey where there is no current. Now, we have an equation. We say from V, potential V, from A to C1, is simply equal to E1 because there is no current, and this is sigma into L1, and sigma we know is given by A into rho R plus L into rho plus R. This is the potential gradient, the sigma into L1. Now we are inserting a plug key K2, which is this battery E2. This one is connected in place of E1. This was connected because of K1. Now we'll plug on K2. Now E2 will be connected. Again, we'll do the same thing for E2. We have to slide this C1, or we have to slide this jockey so that this current becomes 0. Let us say that this is a C2 point where we get current equal to 0. Balancing length AC2 from A to C2 is L2. So this is the balancing point now for this E2. Again, same thing, VAC2 will be equal to E2, equal to sigma L2. Now, we will take this one and we will take this one and divide them. So, what do we get? E1 by E2 will be equal to L1 by L2. And with this equation, the EMF of two cells can be compared. And in practice, if you see, the EMF of a cell is determined by comparing it with the EMF of a standard cell, right? So, we can employ this equation. We can also obtain desired value of this potential difference between any two points of the wire by choosing appropriate value of resistance, this R, as resistance box. Because the potential difference of the order of 10 to the power minus 6 volt, that is 1 microvolt, or order of 1 millivolt 10 to the power minus 3 volt can be obtained here. Potentiometer can be employed if you want to measure very, very small EMF of this range. Now, if one thing need to be ascertained, that if two cells of EMF E1 and E2 are they first connected in helping condition and then in opposing condition, that is say this is like this and the other one is like this. So what do we get? If two cells of EMF E1 and E2 are first connected in helping condition, then in opposing condition. So what will happen? The length of the null point is respectively, you say L3 and L4. So it will be L3 plus L4 by L3 minus L4. This is what is going to happen. Now, in order to determine the internal resistance of a cell, what do we have to do? We have to determine the internal resistance of a cell. So we can use potentiometer in order to measure the internal resistance of a cell. If you see this figure, the cell which with EMF E, this is cell with EMF E, whose internal resistance R is to be determined. We want to find out the internal resistance which is connected across a small resistance box, or capital R you can say. This is a resistance box. And there is a key. If you on the key, it will be connected. If you off the key, it will not be connected to the circuit. So, null point say C1 is obtained. Potentiometer wire when this key K2 is open, when resistance box is not connected. So at this time there will be no flow of current. There will be no flow of current through this cell because the key is not connected, which is called the open circuit. Now if this cell null point C1 is obtained at say distance L1 from point A, say from this point, then we have already known that that is potential from A to C1 is simply equal to this E. And this will be sigma L1. L1 is the distance from A to the C1. Now, when we press this K2, or you can say when K2 is closed, the resistance box will come in the circuit. And this null point C2 is again obtained on the wire at say some appropriate value of R. So, if the terminal voltage of cell is V and the null point is now obtained to be L2, previously it was L1. Now, when we press this key, we obtain AC2 as L2. So, this V AC2 will be equal to V and this is equal to sigma into L2. So, ultimately what we got? Epsilon by V, we divide these two, equal to L1 by L2. Sigma, sigma gets cancelled. We are dividing these two. So, this E by V equal to L1 by L2, but we know that by Ohm's law, E will be equal to I, like V equal to IR. So, EMF is equal to I and external resistance plus internal resistance. So, in place of E, we can write IR plus R. That is exactly what we are doing here. We will put E as I into R plus R. So, this V will be equal to IR. We will put V equal to IR. So, this equation becomes R, capital R plus R by small r and L1 by L2. Okay. Now, from here, we can find out the internal resistance. You can take others on the right hand side. This is the equation by which we can find the internal resistance of this cell. Joule's law. Electrical energy. Power, Joule's law. In this figure, a battery which is having a terminal voltage V volt is connected to a resistance R and the circuit is completed. Right? At end A, this end A of the resistor, say energy of 1 coulomb positive charge is say V joule. So, this energy per unit positive charge will represent what? Will be simply the electric potential, because potential is directly related to the energy. So, the electric current is considered due to the motion of electron, which is a reality. So, it can be concluded or said that the unit negative charge possesses a electrical energy of V joule at point B of this resistor, right? And we have already known when the electron acquires some drift velocity, they experience collision. When the positive ion oscillate about their mean position, and the energy required by the electron is partly transferred to the ions and making their oscillation faster and more random. And we have already seen that the heat energy is the kinetic energy associated with the random motion of constituent particles of a substance. So, in accordance to this, the increase in the energy of oscillation of the ion due to collision with electrons, it will manifest as heat energy. So, the heat energy released in a conductor on passing an electric current is called the Joule heat. It's called the Joule heat, and the effect is known as Joule effect. The effect is Joule effect. So, the potential difference of V volt, this V volt applied between two ends of a conductor, means that V joule energy is utilized when a unit charge passes through the conductor. If you say Q coulomb charge passes through a conductor in T time, so the electric energy which is consumed in T second is nothing but the heat energy produced during that particular time. So, if we know that W is equal to V into Q. So this is the heat energy produced in time. And let us assume that a steady current I is produced due to this charge. Then I is charge, this current is charge flowing per unit time. So, Q becomes IT. Now, let us put this Q equal to IT here. So, we get W equal to VIT. Now, we also know that V equal to IR. Now, put IR here in place of V. We get W equal to I square RT. So, electrical energy converted into heat energy per unit time is given by, which is actually the power. Work done per unit time, take time here in the denominator, work done per unit time is nothing but the power. It is equal to I square R. So, R here is the ohmic resistance of the conductor. It does not depend on V, that is the potential difference, or I. If we consider this R as a constant, the heat energy produced will be simply, this will be directly proportional to this I square. And this equation is known as Joule's law. The power is directly proportional to the square of current. The heat produced per unit time on passing electric current through a conductor at a given temperature is directly proportional to the square of the electric current, as I just indicated. This is your Joule's law. So, heat energy produced here are in Joule. Energy is in Joule. And we need to know the relationship between the Joule and the calorie if we want to express heat energy in calories, because heat is generally taken in calorie. So, this relation was given by Joule, James Prescott Joule, according to which W, work done, is equal to J into H. W is in Joule, and this J is what we are talking about, and this H is in calorie, and this J is the Joule's constant, or you can say mechanical equivalent of heat. It has a proper value, fixed value, which is equal to 4.2 Joule per calorie. So, heat will be W by J. W was I square RT. Divide by J, we get I square RT by J, and this is the heat produced. What are the practical applications of Joule heating? Whenever we pass current, there is heat production. Sometimes it is less, sometimes it is more. So, this generation of heat on this passing electric current through a conductor is inevitable. You cannot stop it. So, in most cases, it is actually unwanted. So, electric energy gained by charges is actually wasted in the form of heat energy. And this is known as ohmic dissipation or ohmic law. Just consider there is a part of electric power supplied to electric motor. This is used to pump water to overhead tank in our houses. Most of it is wasted in the form of heat. And in addition to that, when current is passed through the circuit, properties of some components in the circuit change because heat is being produced. Long distance electric transmission is done at very high voltage. Why? Because we want to reduce the ohmic losses as possible. So, this Joule heat is useful in case of domestic application. Joule heat will be immediately clear if you think of electric appliances like your electric iron, your electric toaster, electric oven, electric kettle, room heater. Joule heat is also used in electric bulbs to produce light. And when electric current is passed through the filament of a bulb, its temperature rises considerably due to the heat produced, and it will start emitting the light. And the filament should consist of metal of very high melting point, like the tungsten melting point is 3380 degree centigrade, right? And it should be thermally isolated from the surrounding. So only a very small fraction of electric power supplied converts into light. Normally, if you see a bulb, it emits one candela of light energy per 1 watt electrical power being consumed. A very common application of joule heat is fuse wire. We use it in our houses circuits. This fuse wire is a piece of wire which is having a very low melting point, like the aluminium, like the iron and lead. And this connected in series with the appliance. So if the current is passing is large than what is pre-decided, the fuse wire is going to melt and the circuit will break, and that will protect the appliance. Electric current divides among two resistors connected in parallel in such a way that the joule heat dissipated becomes minimum. Using this fact, we have to obtain the equation of division of current. Okay. Suppose a current I divides into two parts. Two resistors are there, say R1, R2. So here I1 is going to R1. So we say I minus I1 will go to R2. So I equal to I1 plus I2, that is I2 will be equal to, this is I2, I2 will be equal to I minus I1. So the joule heat produced in time will be what? Because of this resistance, it will be I1 square R1. Because of this, it will be I minus I1 square into R2, which is this one. If you want to find out the minimum, we have to find out the differential and put it to 0. So dH by dI1 will, this I1 is what is known to us, or you can say is the variable because of which, or on the basis of which we can use the differential. So dH by dI1, so you have to differentiate this equation with respect to I1. You get 2I1 R1 plus 2I minus I1 minus 1 R2, and we have to put it at 0. So I1 will be I into R2 by R1 plus R2. And if you want to find out I2, you can just minus I1 from here, and this is the I2. This is I1, this is I2. When two resistors are connected with the voltage V individually, the powers obtained are P1 and P2. Then they are connected in series, they are connected in parallel. You have to show that the product of powers in this 1 and 2 is P1 into P2. So let us start with taking these two resistances as R1 and R2. So what will be the power P is V square by R. So the potential is same. So for P1, it will be V square by R1. P2 will be equal to V square by R2. So take R here, P1 here. This will be R1 will be equal to V square by P1. R2 will be equal to V square by P2. So their combined resistance will be R1 plus R2 because they are in series, and the combination is connected to the voltage V. So what is the final P? Because power in the case of series connection, it will be V square by R. R is R1 plus R2. Now we'll substitute the value of R1 and R2 from here in this equation. So we get PS will be equal to V square by P1 plus V square by P2, and which is equal to P1 P2 by P1 plus P2. Now, what is the equivalent resistance when they are connected in parallel? It will be R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. Now, what will be the power? V square by again R. We are putting this R here. Right? So we can take it up. And now, using this equation 2, which is this one, we can put these values V square by P1, V square by P1, V square by P2. All these we can vary because V square by R1 R2 into R1 plus R2. And we will use this formation in order to put this value, right? And after this rearranging, we get PP equal to P1 plus P2 into P1 plus P2. That means all the R has, V by R has to be removed by, or has to be replaced by P, what you have to do. So what do we get? This PP is equal to P1 plus P2, right? And as the voltage across the resistor is same in the parallel connection, we could obtain this equation directly also. How? We can say from equation this 3 and this is 4, we can say the series power into the parallel power will be equal to P1 into P2. This is what is the result. A battery having an EMF E and resistance R is connected with a resistance R. prove that the power in the external resistance R is maximum when capital R equal to small r. So, first of all, we'll find out the power for the external resistance equal to I square into R, capital R. And this I is what? I is given by this E divided by capital R plus small r, right? Because of the Ohm's law, and this is the total resistance. We'll put it here. Now, we want to find out the value which is minimum or maximum. So, in this case, we have to find maximum. So, we just put this differentiate dP by dR, because R is the value by which we are going to differentiate, and put it to 0. So, when we differentiate it, put it to 0, you can see that R becomes capital R and small r becomes equal. Let us summarize the current electricity. Electric current, when charge or charges are in motion, it is nothing but electric current. So, the amount of charge flowing per unit time across any cross-sectional area A of a conductor held perpendicular to the direction of flow of charge is called the current I. For a steady flow, I equal to Q by T. If the rate of flow is changing, it is not a steady flow, then we say I equal to delta Q by delta T, and limit delta T tends to 0. And this is dQ by dt if it is changing. Electric current density, it is the amount of electric current flowing, that is the electric charge flowing per unit time, per unit cross-sectional area perpendicular to the current at that point. So, if the cross-sectional area is not perpendicular, that means if this is like this, this area is making theta with the direction of electric field, then the current density at any point j will be equal to dI by dA cos theta. This dI equal to j dA cos theta, which is simply equal to j dot dA. If the cross-sectional area is perpendicular like this, and if J is constant over the entire cross-section, then I will be equal to for whole area J dot dA. J will come outside, this dA integral is A, I will be equal to JA, J will be equal to IA, I by A. This is the electric current density. Ohm's law. What is Ohm's law? Under a definite physical condition, that is say constant temperature, the current I flowing through the conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference V applied across it end. So, this V by I equal to R, or you can say V equal to IR. So, the reciprocal of the resistance, if you take 1 by R, this is called the conductance of the material. Conductance. Resistivity, the resistance of a conductor is given by R equal to rho L by A. Rho is R A by L. We are rearranging it. So, the reciprocal of resistivity is called the conductivity of the material. That is 1 by rho is conductivity, sigma. Drift velocity and relaxation time. The velocity of electron corresponding to the effective drift displacement of the electron in the presence of electric field is known as the drift velocity. And what is the relaxation time? The average time between two consecutive collision of the electron with ions is called the relaxation time or tau. The drift velocity achieved by electron during this tau time, the relaxation time, Vd equal to A tau. This A can be written as F by M. F is E into capital E into small e. The relationship between the drift velocity and current I is given by N into A, Vd, drift velocity, V sub D into E. The relationship between drift velocity and current density J is given by I by A. Again, we get N into E Vd because A gets cancelled here. The relationship between the resistivity and conductivity, that is sigma and rho, sigma is given by N E square tau by M, and P is given by M by N E square tau. What is the mobility? It is the drift velocity of charge carrier per unit electric field intensity. That is, mu is given by Vd by E, which is sigma by Ne. You can use this, sigma is equal to Ne into mu. The conductivity of semiconductor is given by sigma Ne. This is because of electron, this is because of holes. So, Ne, number of electrons, number of holes, E, electron, mu E, mu H, and mu is the mobility. Right? Temperature dependence of resistivity. Now, the relationship between the resistivity of a metallic conductor and temperature is given by, there is an empirical formula. Rho theta will be equal to rho theta 0, 1 plus alpha theta minus theta 0. Okay. So this theta 0 is the reference temperature, and for a resistance you can just change it to R theta equal to R theta 0 1 plus alpha theta minus theta 0. Alpha is the temperature coefficient of the resistance. And for metal, this this will be alpha will be positive. This is alpha. That means the resistivity of metal increases with increasing temperature. For semiconductor, this alpha will be negative because their resistivity decreases with increasing temperature. Superconductivity, the resistance of certain materials reduces to almost zero when the temperature is lowered below certain specific or definite temperature, which is known as the critical temperature, TC. The material in this state is known as superconductor, and this phenomena is known as superconductivity. The EMF of a cell and terminal voltage, when unit positive charge or unit positive charge is driven from negative terminal to the positive terminal due to non-electric forces, the energy gained by the charge or work done by the non-electrical forces is known as the EMF E of the battery. The potential difference between two points of a battery is called the terminal voltage. And the terminal voltage and E is related by V equal to E minus IR. Secondary cell, the cells which can be restored to its original condition by reversing the chemical process, that means they can be recharged. These are called the secondary cells or lead accumulator. Charging. If the secondary cell is connected to some other source which is having a larger EMF, the current may enter the cell at the positive terminal, leave it at the negative terminal. So the electrical energy is converted here into chemical energy, and this is called the charging of the cell. And for charging of a lead storage cell, lead accumulator, VITV is equal to EIT plus I square RT plus I square small rt. And I is given by V minus E by small r plus capital R. Junction or branch point. So, if we have a network, this is a point where more than two current or conductor they meet. Loop is a closed circuit formed by like this. By conductors is known as loop, and this joint is like this. This is joint. Kirchhoff rules, there are actually two rules. First rule says that the algebraic sum of all the electric current meeting at the junction point is 0. That is, if it is I, this is I1, this is I2. So, if this is coming and these two are going, so I2 will be equal to I plus I1. So this is, you can say. For the second rule, if you take a loop, for any closed loop, the algebraic sum of the products of resistances and the respective current flowing through them is equal to the algebraic sum of EMFs applied along the loop. Sigma IR will be equal to sigma E. Then connection of resistor connected in series can be simply just added, and parallel will be one added in the reciprocal form. 1 by RP equal to 1 by R1, 1 by R2 like 1 by RN. RP will be equal to equivalent resistance of N resistors. RS is the equivalent resistance of N resistors connected in series. Series connection of cells, for the series connection of cells, two cells, say E1 and E2, with having internal resistances R1 and R2, I is given by E1 plus E2 by R, and this is equivalent resistance of small resistances. This is E equivalent and this is R equivalent. This is capital R, the external resistance. This I is the current flowing through the external resistance, which is connected across the series connection. Equivalent E is given by E1 plus E2. R equivalent is given by R1 plus R2. Parallel connection of cells, if two cells EMF E1 and E2 and the internal resistance R1 and R2, they are connected in parallel, then I is given by E1 by R1 plus E2 by R2 by 1 plus R by R1 plus R by R2. We can rearrange it and finally we can write it like this. E equivalent is given by this one, that is E1 R1 plus E2 R1 by R1 plus R2. R equivalent is given by R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. This is parallel connection of cells. Wheatstone bridge. The Wheatstone bridge is that formation because in balance condition R1 by R2 will be equal to R3 by R4. So this is kind of like this. R1, R2, R3, R4. Here no current will form. There will be no current in balance condition. Potentiometer, it is a device in which one can obtain continuously varying potential difference between any two points which can be measured simultaneously. So what is the principle? The PD, potential difference between any two points of potentiometer, is directly proportional to the distance between these two points. And this we have already, you know, proved it and found this equation. So rho is given by VL by L. Take L here, and this is rho is equal to this E into rho by R plus L rho plus R rho. The sigma is the potential gradient. Joule effect, the heat energy released in a conductor on passing an electric current is called the joule heat, or the effect is known as joule effect. The joule heat is given by WI square RT. H is given by I square RT by J. The energy, electrical energy consumed per unit time, or heat energy produced per unit time, is electric power, which is P equal to I square R. That means P is directly proportional to the I square. And this is Joule's law, the heat energy produced per unit time on passing the electric current through a conductor at a given temperature is directly proportional to the square of the electric current. Ohmic losses on passing electric current through a conductor and electric energy gained by charges is wasted in the form of heat energy. And this is known as ohmic losses. So, this is all about this topic. Thank you so much and take care of yourself.